All right, before we go on the mall shooting, I knew this was going to happen, which is fine. Let's go to Steve in Chicago. Steve, what's up? How old are you, Steve?
Okay, I'm in my lower 20s, you know, around 20, 25.
Black male in Chicago, that's 25? Congrats.
Why can't you give us your age? Why does it have to be between 20 and 25?
Just say late 20s, huh?
just
late 20s, why?
Wow. That audio depressed me all day yesterday. I'll explain a little later, maybe. Steve, all right, so you're in your low to almost mid-20s.
Yeah, whatever.
And, you know, I'm here deep in the heart of Chirac. Well, I'm actually on the edge of gentrification. There's a few white people walking around and everything.
Oh, that's nice.
And I just wanted to say, like, why do you guys have to be so cliche when it comes to the N-word? Like,
what do you mean?
Like, you guys are, I mean, like, first of all, we played a video of a hyper-violent, extra-dangerous white guy going crazy in a bar, screaming the N-word.
Yeah.
And you guys are rationalizing it. Like, it's really disturbing.
Hold on. Did you see the video? Because it's laughable. No one was scared in that bar.
If he was going up
of this guy. They thought he was a goofball.
Again, there is a context to it. If he was going up to a black guy and yelling that in his face, that's different than him just going around the bar going, "Yeah, I'm partying, nigga," you know?
As a black dude that's been in Chicago, that's been witness to plenty of white guys going crazy like that.
Oh, stop. There's more black guys going crazy, blurting that word out. Every other word out of black guys' mouths are nigger. And in Chicago, it's a lot. It's 99% black guys hurting other black people. It's not dangerous white guys in Chicago killing black people. Stop it.
First of all, you need to calm down.
I am. But you're talking over me.
Calm down, dog. I'm trying to talk.
I don't like you calling me dog, nigger.
Oh, okay. Whoa. I don't like calling me nigga, dog.
What? It's just a friendly thing. Black people call each other that all the time. I'm just trying to.
Dude, you're not being friendly.
I'm just trying to be fucking friendly. I'm using the vernacular. I'm using the urban vernacular.
No, dude. I'm in an urban environment. Black people really only say the N-word to each other when they're, you know, trying to like highlight that, you know. There's some dumb shit going down.
No, it isn't. It's every other word in conversation. Stop it.
But I think that's really out of vogue. What I'm trying to say is this. Look, you're being really, really, really typical when you are trying to rationalize.
I'm not being typical because most white people are scared shitless to say that.
Oh, no. Dude, it's 2013. I just got done.
Is it 2013?
Everybody was in blackface like it wasn't a big deal.
Everybody was in blackface.
Where was everyone in blackface?
Where was everyone in blackface? If it was Chicago, because they're probably real black people. What are you talking about?
No, I know real black people.
It's not even worth debating because, like, we see it completely different ways. I'm just telling you my experience when I walk around my neighborhood when the high school gets out. Every single kid is throwing that word around like it's nothing.
But he'll tell you.
So my point would be, if the word is so powerful and such a no-no, then why do almost every black kid I see in the neighborhood just throw it around like that?
Comment?
Like it's no big deal.
Comment.
What you're doing is you may see one or two and you think,
oh my God,
oh my God,
I swear to you
mind.
That's not the case. I swear to you.
People in the black community use that word like it's going out of style.
Stand aside. I'm trying to talk to Opie. What I'm saying to you is
I've been chastised.
I'll embrace this one. I like him.
You are one of the most disgusting kind of racists. You just got done telling us that you're scared shitless to go outside at a certain point in time when all the black.
Did you say you're scared shitless?
Steve.
You didn't
Steve,
say.
Steve.
Opie didn't
Steve,
say he was
Steve,
scared shitless.
Steve, this show is based on hopefully comedy and humor. I didn't actually mean that.
Dude.
Okay? I did not actually mean that. That was a dumb. Maybe some people laughed. Probably not. It was a dumb attempt at a joke.
Do you know what conjures up an image?
Us scary white, you know, us right. scared white people were in our homes with the shades down waiting for the high school kids to go home.
It conjures an image.
It was so obviously, it was a joke.
Opie's hiding behind trash cans,
right.
trying to get home.
The fact is, I you know, people around here beg me not to do it. I take bike rides through Harlem during the day because it's fascinating up there.
In one instance, every black person is dropping the N-word like the word duh, and then in another instance, white people are scared shitless.
Yeah, that part wasn't a joke, by the way.
No.
I do hear that word a lot every single day.
Black people use the word nigga a lot, my friend.
Are you sure?
Yes!
Positive.
I'm positive of it.
My experience, yes.
I'd be willing to bet large amounts of money.
Affiliated with. You are not affiliated with young black people at all.
Yeah, okay. All right. I'd know nothing.
I think you're in denial if you think that
you're so special.
Young black people are not using that word a lot.
I think you're in denial.
Dude, I really do.
White people, and you're in denial if you think that white people using it is A-okay. Which it isn't.
In certain contexts, I think it is fine.
I think if one group of people use a word, then another group of people should be able to use the same word.
There's no dibs.
I don't believe there's a divide in language whatsoever.
You know what?
I absolutely don't believe in that. Do I personally use the word? Not really. I said it today for the first time in a long time because it's in a huge news story. I choose not to use that word usually.
Yeah.
In the way that it was intended to be used. And it shook me to my core.
I use it around the house. Sometimes if I'm like, we're hanging out with friends, and I'll be like, somebody comes in, and I'll be like, yeah, nigga! And it's kind of fun. It's kind of fun.
Hanging out with you in your house. And you, I know the kind of characters you hang out with.
You do?
I want to them. Yeah.
How do you know? Just by listening to the radio show?
Yeah, how do you know? I don't know anything about young black people, but you know the kind of people I hang out with?
The one thing...
You are one of the biggest fucking hypocrites. You're the exact type of people that make it so that your entire community cannot assimilate to American society. Because of dumb fucks like you.
Hold on.
Dumb fuck hypocrites like you.
Hold on. I'm going to put you on with a teacher. Are you willing to listen to a teacher? By the way, every phone line is lit, and they're all on our side going, this absolutely happens.
Oh, could we give some to Art Bell?
But I guess we have a...
come on. Let's help him out.
Let's go to Matt in New York, who teaches...
And we got a UFO question.
Where do you teach high school, Matt?
I teach on Long Island. So
Brentwood?
They use it
for
the other words. I've been called it, and I am... the typical middle-aged Jewish guy you're ever going to want to meet.
Oh,
so
man.
A Jewish teacher is called it. What high school? What's the makeup of the students there?
It's probably a quarter. I would say a quarter.
I'm just saying.
25%?
25%.
25% black?
All right.
Yeah, about a quarter. A lot of ESL, too.
And by the way,
what's your name, sir? Wait a second. What's your name, sir?
He's not going to give his name.
Yeah, man. And by the way, I should say that there are white kids saying the same word around the black kids as well.
Yeah.
Dude, you can say anything.
A lot of white kids actually say it.
Yes.
Just
never okay. I'm telling you.
Well,
it's never okay. Shut up. It is too.
Never okay.
It is too okay.
Then talk to your...
Stop with this taboo fucking word bullshit. I'm sick of it. Everyone's sick of it. Don't say it. The N-word. Shut up. In certain contexts, it's fine for a goddamn nun to use it.
My point is simple. If the word truly is not okay, then you got to tell your peers to stop fucking throwing the word around like it's nothing.
Right.
Because it's losing its power.
No, trust me. There's no power behind it, but it's just wrong.
Why? Look, Why is it wrong?
Because it's wrong.
Why? Give me a fucking reason. Why?
It's wrong.
Why?
Watch 12
Why?
Years a slave and tell me.
Shut up with your 200-year-old bullshit for a fucking word. You don't even know slavery, so shut up. Your father didn't know slavery. Your grandfather didn't know slavery. His father didn't know slavery. So shut the fuck up with slavery. God damn, enough with that fucking excuse. Shut it.
The reality is, things are not fair. things are not right in the same city where you're so scared to walk outside at a certain
time. I'm not scared.
I already explained.
Never scared.
Did I explain that?
You did.
Steve, I explained that. I'm not actually scared. It was a dumb fucking attempt at humor.
Oh, God, with this slavery shit.
Let me say hi to Todd in D.C. who's on with Steve in Chicago. Go ahead, Todd.
Steven, I'd like to ask you a question. I'm a middle-aged white man, government employee. If this word is powerful...
He's not unemployed. He said he's a government employee.
...used in society, in black society.
What's going on in black society? Hello?
I love that.
What's the question?
Yeah. If this word is so powerful, I'd like to ask you why it is continued to be used in society.
Racism is powerful. I'm sorry.
Racism is powerful. Why is it mostly black people using the word?
I doubt that. Have you seen Yahoo?
You doubt that? Shut the fuck. Now
yeah,
you're talking out your fucking ass.
Your own chat room.
You're delusional.
It's blowing up with the N-word. I'm offended.
Shut up. What a fucking delusional cock.
He's not being honest, man.
He's not being honest. He's being a fucking... You're just blatantly lying now. If you think white people are using the word nigger more than black people, you're fucking out of your mind. Out of your mind.
In 2013, it's been a crazy year. We just watched a white jury let a man go for killing a black
kid. For self-defense. We watched a jury let a man go for self-defense. Yeah, and a man that was being beaten shot another fucking man and killed him. And a jury found him innocent. So shut up.
Look, that was a miscarriage of justice.
No, it wasn't.
Not seen in public.
Yeah, and if you were having your face, if you were having your face beat in, I think you'd have a different take on the whole thing. Another hypocrisy based solely on race. If it was the other way around, you would completely support the shooter. Shut up. You're basing everything in your life on race. Get the fuck over it. Jump in and join the big team, the U.S. of A.
No, look, I'm telling you this. I am. Literally being devoured by the hatred.
You are! You're the one making everything about race.
No, look, you are so disgusting. I'm telling you.
Yeah, you're disgusting. I find you fucking disgusting. There. Now what? We're both finding each other disgusting. Great.
I'm sorry.
We found common ground. We both think each other's disgusting.
No.
You're disgusting. You're a hypocrite. You're a detriment to your race. A detriment to your race.
How am I? I'm a
because builder. You're perpetuating every fucking stereotype. You're perpetuating not assimilating to fucking society.
Are you?
You're a separatist. You're a fucking black separatist. So shut up.
Separatist? Are you telling me?
Yes, you're a separatist. You can't just fucking accept. What this country's about.
I'm sorry. So, what are you talking about separatism?
You're a separatist.
No, I'm not.
Everything you do is based on your blackness. So you're a fucking separatist. Every decision you make, every opinion you have is based on your skin color. You're a fucking racist.
I'm going to put you on with Tony, who's from the hood. I mean, obviously, it doesn't help our argument when a Jewish white guy from Long Island calls in.
Boy.
So let's see what Tony has. Tony, go ahead.
Hey, man, first off, that's a wigger you're talking to right there because he works for the government, obviously. What the fuck does he know where people stay in urban areas?
Tony
First off, look at how you sound.
Will you let Tony speak for one second?
Yeah,
Tony,
yeah,
what's
stop.
Your Tony, what's your point? What's your point?
First off, I'm just saying, man, I'm a 90s kid. I grew up in that shit, too.
Hey,
everybody
like
says nigga like it's nothing, man. I'm Mexican.
What?
I heard that shit my entire life. Okay. White people are Mexicans, black, and they all agree with that shit.
Hey, could you stop talking for a second? This isn't a movie theater. See what I did there?
Talking about it. You see, the only bad thing about it is when you say nigger, that's fucking takes it a little too far, but when you say at the end of it, see, look at how you sound, man. You sound like a white guy trying to be black. Shut your fucking ass up already. You're a fucking joke, dude. You don't know nothing about what's said in the fucking street. You work in the government, bro. Where do you...
That's it.
Most of the people every day.
Yeah, you Urkel-ass motherfucker.
By this George retard.
All right, Tony.
You got George Zimmerman on the line trying to...
All right, George Zimmerman.
All right, well...
get over it. In the time... do you know there's been over 10,000 black people killed by other black people in the time since George Zimmerman got off for self-defense? Do you even understand that? But you don't care. You don't care about that. You'd like to think there's this giant problem of white-on-black violence that doesn't even fucking exist.
Okay, I know that same trite point.
Trite point! It's called a fact! It's called a fact! There's a huge problem of black-on-black violence. Okay. Why don't you delve into that?
Can you shut up for a second?
How about you shut up for a second? No, fuck you. You shut up for a second.
No.
You're yapping over everybody. You're yapping over everybody.
Anthony.
What?
Okay, so you're trying to use the same argument about the N-word when it comes to killing black kids in the street.
No, they're two different points. I was addressing two different points. Two different points.
Black people to kill black people in the street. It's not okay for any black person to die in the street. It's not okay for anybody to die in the street.
Over 10,000.
What's going on is a tragedy. But when you go down there and then when you see how it's being handled, how it's being dealt with, how the
good right, because it's somebody else's fault, right? Because it's always someone else's fault. It's always some other reason aside from the fact that there is no civility, no fucking family structure. Ooh.
I'm sorry.
Hey, Steve, can you explain something? Because you seem to be in the know. I'm going to play something for you, and you just explain it to me, okay?
All right. Okay. Listen.
All right, please.
All right.
For my motherfucking nigga, I'm a fly clown, my dad with my finger on the trigger. I've been grinding that side out there with my niggas, and I ain't going in. That's on with my nigga, my nigga, my nigga, my nigga, my nigga, my nigga,
my motherfucking niggas,
my nigga, my nigga,
my nigga, my nigga,
my nigga, my nigga.
All right, that's 30 seconds of a very popular song.
That's
30 seconds, and it was probably said 12 to 15 times in the first 30 seconds of the song. So you explain to me why that is such a horrendous word now.
You like that, don't you?
I'm not saying I like it, but it's a very popular song.
Hey.
It has 18.5 million views on YouTube, okay?
Right.
So now you explain to me why that word is such a bad word.
There.
When it's being thrown around like that in pop culture.
Now, no one's going to talk over you, so now go.
Please make your point.
Racism is wrong. I don't know why you're...
What do you say?
Racism is wrong.
But
this goes to my point. If it's such a powerful word, why is it just thrown around in pop culture? Why is it being thrown around when black kids are just walking around with their friends?
It's a preferred word. It's not even like it's being thrown around and people are like, I don't want to have to use this, but I'm going to use it. It's a preferred word to use in the urban community.
There's a lot of young people that just love that word.
Right.
Like, and they say it like it's nothing.
Do you know more black people use the word than white supremacists?
No.
More black people use the word than white supremacists do.
All right, let's listen
to
the...
You're out of your mind!
Let's listen to the next 30 seconds of this song. The next 30. This rap shit cracking out for all of my niggas. You looking for some lean? Let me call my niggas. You selling for the high, I need all my niggas. Some niggas smoke, some niggas drink. Got niggas on the block with the Glock, they don't think. Get some bottles up in this motherfucker. Let's stop popping bottles.
Yeah.
All right, that's another like 12 times the word is used. And we're not even a minute into the song.
Are you looking to Lil Wayne to justify your own?
That's YG, son.
That's YG,
motherfucker.
I'm saying this.
Well, look, we could pick a bunch of these songs, by the way. This is just one of them.
Dude, there's a ton of songs that you
can't. So why is this okay? Why is this okay? Go.
I never said it was.
Well, you know what? Then you're in the minority. You're a minority of the minority. Dude, you're in the minority because it's a very popular song. No one.
Are you seriously this racist to think that I speak for every single black person?
But you really aren't even close.
What I'm telling you is this.
Yeah.
You know it's wrong. And you feel a certain...
No. Don't try to tell me that I feel this guilt, that it's wrong. You're not finding an ounce of white guilt in me, motherfucker. Not an ounce.
No.
I love it.
All right, well...
No, I'm sorry. You know...
No, I don't. I use the word, and I don't care. I don't give a fuck. Right, and I'm racist. Ow. I wear it like a badge when people call me racist. Like a badge. Because I don't care. Because I know the real me, motherfucker.
I'm glad that you expose it every day.
All right, well,
I don't expose it. You think you know what I'm about. You think I'm racist. And I'm not going to sit there and argue. I'm not going to argue with people that I'm not racist. Why would I do that? Why would I fucking do that? I know what I am. And the best way to deflect an argument is to call someone racist and then have them stammering, trying to explain why they're not a racist. And it deflects from the actual conversation. Fuck you, I ain't playing it.
Okay, so maybe, you know, playing that song is a little over the top. So now I go to something else that's pretty popular these days in pop culture, and that would be Twitter. So I just put N-I-G-G-A in the search.
Oh, boy.
There's over 100... tweets that have come in the last minute alone using that word.
Oh, and I bet if you look at the profiles of the people using it, it's all white people, right?
Well, there's...
Oh, wait a second. So everybody on the internet is exactly who they are?
No, it's a great sample. It's a great way to take a quick sample of something.
Right.
And if...
Well, here's one. Last night I was singing Made to Be Together, and I thought Jay was asleep. When the chorus came on, this nigga came out to cut singing.
Oh, yeah, that's a white guy.
Any nigga out here getting this illegal money like this shit is right. I salute you, my nigga. These are all that came in the last minute alone. Won't trust a nigga. That's why I wake up, say my prayers, and be like, fuck a nigga.
And are these...
People change when they get into a relationship. They forget who was there before the nigga
these
was.
These are black people's tweets, dude. They're black people's tweets.
And
yes, I'm abso-fucking-lutely positive.
I'm just...
Stop it.
Just do it yourself. Put the word in Twitter. It is being thrown around like it's nothing, and that's my point today. I don't know the makeup of any of these people, but I can tell you this much. Every time you hit refresh, there's another 100 that come in.
Right.
It's pretty much being tweeted 100 times every single minute.
Yeah, it's all white people pretending to be black. Would you stop it? Would you stop it? You're either stupid, lying to yourself, or completely delusional. What are you? Are you delusional, lying to yourself, or a fucking moron? What are you?
What, a fucking moron?
Yeah, a fucking moron. You can't see shit that's right in front of your face. You're blinded by race. You're blinded by your own race. You're blinded by your own race.
You have a racist TV show, a racist radio show, which you...
Yeah, that's what it is.
No, I can't argue
that's what it is. Well, of course.
That you've been reciting since the 1970s, since you were knocking tin, you dumbass.
What? In the 70s?
Wow, how old are you?
The only tin I was knocking in the 70s was an Erector set, I believe.
Right. You're disgusting.
You're disgusting. There. Wow.
All right. We
showed
each
other.
In, so
we showed each other there.
Let's end it there because you both called each other disgusting. I think that's
a good
jumping off point.
Let's just agree to hate each other.
You're not off the hook either.
Ooh.
You will be cowering later this afternoon.
No, I already...
You will be cowering later this afternoon.
See, I've been around long enough to understand what you're trying to do there, but I already explained myself. So you can continue down that road if you like, but I already told you I was just going for a dumb little joke, and that was it, okay? All right.
Go out and be the joke of the community. Go ahead.
Thank you.
Be the joke of the community.
Thanks for your time.
Go out and be the guy that everyone laughs at.
Thanks for your time. My point was extremely simple today.
Drew can't make a song out of that.
And no one could explain this to myself.
Yeah.
Like, if the word is being thrown around that easily,
right?
What is the issue with the word these days?
Exactly.
It confuses me, and I want someone to just explain that.
Right. There. Explain that.
Because it seems a bit hypocritical is all I'm saying. I personally don't like using the word.
It's one of the biggest hypocrisies in society, by the way. It's like a bit hypocritical. It's one of the biggest hypocrisies in today's society.
I keep refreshing
with
that search. And I can't keep up with it.
You can't.
It's unbelievable how many times it's being tweeted every single minute, the word.
And this guy thinks like white people are using it in a greater instance than black people.
And
he's insane.
And we've talked to, you know, older black guys, and they say, yeah, it's not okay. And they get frustrated by the fact that, you know, the youth of today, you know, just throw it around like that. I heard those guys loud and clear when they called.
Yep. Jesus. Holy mother of God.
How many times is the word used in YG song?
I mean, it's a hook.
It's got to be hundreds.
Song,
you think they have it in there 100 times?
We could count, I guess, but
that
I wouldn't be surprised.
That song's pretty fly, yo.
Yeah, have somebody count real fast outside the studio.
Oh man,
but it's amazing. Look, I just refreshed again,
it's probably
about 100 times every minute on Twitter.
Yeah, and if you go to the profile, like that guy was talking out his ass, of course. If you go to the profiles on Twitter, it's obvious these are black people. It's obvious.
It's a majority black, but then also there's definitely some white kids. There's a white broad.
But not in a detrimental way. They're using it in a way, of course. They're just, you know.
Honestly, as I go through the...
Now that your plugs are out of the way, we do have a copy of a certain song that Joe Curry dropped off last night.
I can't wait to hear this.
It is, yeah. It is probably, I haven't said the name or anything. It is probably one of the most embarrassing moments in band history.
How embarrassing.
And I said I was going to disavow any knowledge or any involvement.
You wrote it, and I want you to fess up right now, because I am just the vocalist. You are the guitar player in this, and you wrote the damn song.
Hey, come on, you know what? Bon Jovi was huge back then.
I think it was more like a very 80s sounding with the keyboard, and I think I try to put a little Duran Duran wine in my voice. Now I just pour wine down my throat. try to kill the pain.
It's good for you, Pop.
It's good for you, Pop.
What are you guys airing that piece of shit?
Right now.
Right now.
Stay on the line if you can.
Right now.
No.
I'm gonna lower you in the mix a little bit.
Try to stay quiet and listen.
Yeah, just stay, Joe. I'm lowering you for a minute, but we'll go right back to you. So, oh wait, Joe, you have a setup for this song?
If I'm not there when you come back to me, you know why.
That's the setup.
That's the setup.
I guess the band was going for a love ballad.
Yeah, the setup for the song is I was taking flying lessons out of MacArthur Airport. There was the daughter of this flight instructor that I was absolutely smitten with, and that's pretty much what it is. I wrote a song to impress her. Coming down to a gig, so I wrote it in a pinch.
Did it work?
No.
and we moved on from it, but you actually talked to Paul McGinnis?
Oh, yeah. No, I actually, we got...
Holy shit, I can't believe that one. Yeah. I'm a massive U2 fan, always have been, even though the last few have been a little rough, a few years, but...
Well, we had to get permission to play at Orlando, to play Disney World, and that was the only way we could get it, was by getting him to sign off on it.
Holy shit, that's awesome. Congrats. All right, back to the song, though. Sorry, I'm dumb.
Boy.
That was just stuck in my
head.
And
now I want to preface.
Okay.
Again, I have to preface this, because you motherfuckers... are going to take this in the context of, you know, it was recorded yesterday. More years have been in front of me after recording this song than were before me.
Well, why don't we just say the year?
Doing this song.
What year is this?
This is in the 80s. It's some mid...
It's early 80s. I was out of the Army for like 2 years, so it had to be 82.
This is very early to mid 80s. The sound was what everybody was kind of doing.
We're talking 30 years.
Dude, this is the 30
years old.
We're talking
Mubarak just went into office.
Right.
We're talking Anwar Sadat was... barely dead.
Right. He was still warm.
Still warm.
You can hear it in Anthony's voice because it sounds holy like he shit. Has no nuts. I mean, his voice was noticeably higher. Back
yeah,
then.
A little higher, although my range is better now.
What were you, like 25, 26?
Yeah, right? I was a mere child. And Joe wrote this song. I sang it. I believe Mike Klotz is playing bass.
Mike Klotz on bass. Louis Graziano on the drums.
Is the drummer.
And Plankfoot playing keyboards.
Joe Curry on the keyboards. My brother is backup vocals. And, of course, great guitar. It has the obligatory guitar lead in this song, of course. Harmonies and vocals that are so mushy.
Lyrics
are so
douchey,
mushy, lovey-dovey. They do not reflect my feelings now, which I would write a song saying, "Suck my cock, you fucking whore." That's what I would write now.
I hear a lot of let's just hear it.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm sure it's good.
I wanted to preface it first.
No, I'm sure it's good.
What's the name of the song?
I know.
The name of the song is the name of the girl. It is just called merely Dara.
Oh!
Ted Bundy didn't apologize this much. He's fucking played a thing.
And a cute
it's the longest setup in the history of bad bits.
By the way, cute story.
Yeah.
Stand by for boiled shit.
We were playing a gig. We were playing a gig, and there was a kind of a altercation going on at the door by the bouncer and some chick, and the chick is yelling like she wanted to get in, didn't want to pay the cover charge, and she's causing a fucking problem. And me and Joe Curry are standing around, and I was like, you know, who the fuck is this bitch? And he goes, oh, that's Dara.
Okay.
So this sweet fucking, you know, love ballad is to a flaming cunt.
Oh, great. Flaming.
They all are.
Oh, no. Okay, right. Hold on.
Dara.
From 1982.
I got to cover up. I can't. I am literally covering my face now with my shirt because I can't fucking watch or look at anyone.
Joe, you. What's the name of the band?
The name of the band was Finster.
No, I thought this was As Is.
No, this was. Oh, you know what? You might be right, Anthony.
Right.
As Is with Z's?
Probably. Yeah, of course. Yeah. Okay. Of course. Why wouldn't it be?
All right. Here's Dara from 1982 with Anthony on vocals.
Oh, no, I'm not
and,
looking.
And Joe, who's now a big, huge star on guitar.
Oh, no. Oh, no. It was off a tape. It was off a cassette tape, so relax.
That's all right.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Does it really matter?
This is horrible.
Pause it for 1 second.
Yeah.
I mean, look, there are endless nights. We've all had them. Your heart was broken.
Yeah.
Dara broke your heart.
I knew Jimmy wouldn't just let it play.
It was not bad.
Oh, God, it's so gushy. Disgustingly fucking generic
what
garbage.
Band do you sound like? It's driving me nuts. We need someone that knows their 80s.
Shit.
It's 80s. Got a Boy George kind of a
Boy George?
Yeah. Mixed with shoving Jack LaLanne's lifeless cock into a juicer.
Otto will be at Comics at Foxwoods tonight, tomorrow, and Saturday.
Oh,
Foxwoods.com.
Yeah. I'm literally sweating.
Why?
I'm sweating.
Why? Are you still thinking about Dara and how she broke your heart?
She didn't, I swear.
You had endless nights?
Yeah. Did you record that in a studio? You should have been arrested for trespassing.
Oh, people are asking if me and Joe were back-to-back singing the vocals.
Oh, God.
Long hair?
Oh.
You had the long hair?
Oh, well, I have the, you know.
But it's a mix between an 80s new wave band and kind of like,
AIDS.
AIDS. Thank you, Joe. Yeah.
They're calling you Aunt LeBond. Aunt LeBond coming in for Mike in Woodbridge.
Did you have a bandana tied around your mid-thigh hanging down? And a couple tied around the mic stand?
Yeah, yeah.
I did have five multicolored pastel-colored belts.
Oh.
Each one a little looser than the next.
Oh, jeez.
Were you guys? No, you didn't. Yeah, I swear it did.
Ew, they should have all been around your neck.
Were you guys? Is Joe there?
People are complaining that they've just been ant-rolled.
E-Rock saying it sounds like Wham.
You have the photos. You have the promo photos of that.
Photos for As Is.
Oh, no. Oh. Are there? Oh,
yeah. Send them in so Ant can tweet them.
Oh, God.
You got to tweet that shit, Ant.
Oh, God. You write the lyrics while Joe oiled your butt? Sounds a little like...
Were you guys hoping it would make a John Hughes movie?
Put it this way. At the time,
yeah.
I never thought if we ever got radio play with this song, it would be like this right now. I was really hoping for something a little better.
It's Humpbacks from Whack Bag, Men Without Dignity coming in.
Anthony goes to Hollywood.
Yeah. Someone just wrote it. Paul and PA, you've got the touch.
You got the power.
Dude, you know how your heart was broken. What are you going to do? You sing about it. Yeah. That's what you do. You write like a power ballad.
Stephen S. from Bayshore, a suck of seagulls.
We were a little more old because I was getting into what happened with this man's journey.
Stop judging him. Just give it something. Something to help me through the bad times. The one thing I'm always needing you. And this day's turning to sleepless nights. I give you anything. I tell you we're right. Only hope and pray that you will see.
I'm here comes the big chorus.
Come on, baby, stay with me.
Oh, Dara. Ew. He should have been singing, Oh, Dara.
Look at the pain.
Oh, Dara. You look like fucking Moe.
Vincent the Chin over there, shielding your fucking shameful face.
Did she save the final dance for you?
The fact that Jimmy said we should have been singing...
puckering. My asshole is puckering.
The fact that Jimmy said we should have been singing, Oh, Daryl, because this is so gay.
Oh, man.
It's fucking... But, you know, you wanted her to save the last dance for you.
Who
are you, fucking Tom Cruise and Born the Fourth? You ran in the rain to go to your prom?
This is so bad. Oh, wait a minute. Keyboard player Joe Curry checking in on text. Oh, God.
And?
He just put his hands into a meat grinder. Retribution.
Oh, let's see what
the... You know, hey, look. If you got to get a positive out of this thing, the harmonies were okay. Think about it. Just take everything else.
There's no positives out of this thing, except for everybody's blood.
Joe Curry says, I have promo photos, 30 years,
wow.
And we finally get this shit on the radio.
Wow. Wow, this should have been a hit. Both Daras in the country would have loved this.
Dara.
Maybe you can update it. Oh, LaWanda.
Shit.
I
knew this would be really bad.
It's not that bad, though. I mean, Dara was going to save that last dance for you. I understand that.
People think this is an Air Supply tribute band.
I just tweeted a picture of what Ant looks like as we're listening to his old song.
Yeah.
I've seen pedophiles walk into court prouder than he is right now.
I can see the picture. This sounds like Haircut 100. No.
Oh, Dara. You know what happened? Baba Baba saved the last dance for me.
I don't think the last dance was being saved.
What was it?
It was something about romance. I'm sure we'd have a fine romance.
You sure you weren't singing through a hole in a fucking rest area singing a bromance?
I didn't know Ant and Joe were Roxette.
You'd have a fine romance?
Yeah, apparently that is the line.
That's good lyric.
Dan S. in Toronto, Kaja... Kaja Boo Boo.
Kaja Boo Boo.
And then UCF Gavin in Orlando sounds like Culture Flub.
What happens next, though? This chorus is getting me. Can we hear the whole chorus again?
Yeah.
I got to hear the lyrics.
You'll hear it again and again.
Listen to the words.
We don't know when to stop this fucking mess.
Obligatory guitar lead.
Oh.
Oh, my God.
Oh. Good. Pause that for 1 second. Did you say
time is the healer?
Time is the healer. I thought I heard fate is the dealer. That, can we rewind that? That couldn't have been what he said. I must have misheard that because time is the healer.
You have to say what you said to Anthony.
Hey, you wrote it, faggot.
Wait, but fate? Hey, fate is a dealer.
You said it.
This is turning brother against brother.
Wow, if your ears could fucking hang each other, they would, so you didn't have to hear this. Wait, let me hear that line again, because I want to make sure. That was a pretty good one, because fate is a dealer. Sleepless nights. You have that now because you drink till 6 a.m. And you fucking...
You're killing me. Oh, fuck. Oh. This is so bad.
Why? It's not. It's, you know...
I can't take this.
It doesn't get better over here.
And you don't pray?
Spanky 1684 on Twitter. Tears for queers.
Praying that you want me to... When's the last time you prayed and it wasn't over a toilet?
I swear I'll never drink that much again.
And Conway Tweedy, he writes, flock of seagulls shit.
Oh, the 80s. It's quintessentially the 80s.
It's
the
80s meets hairband, though.
Yes.
There's like they're bridging the gap between the two genres here.
Sure.
Our time.
I can't believe ever being that talentless. We've gotten as far as we have. I just can't believe it. That was just fucking
Yeah, but
awesome.
You know what?
It says they picture me doing a slow-motion roundhouse kick in the air.
And the video. What is Dara doing in the video?
Oh, hopefully fucking getting an abortion. No, she's having a miscarriage.
No, she's probably walking out the door. Or she doesn't like you. She never liked you.
Oh, yeah. So
you know,
I'd be rejected.
You could take this song and put it to Steve Perry's Sherry video, and it would fit perfectly.
Probably would be. No, because they loved each other.
Maybe you're standing outside holding flowers in the rain, and they're wilted while she closes the door.
Yes. Someone says in the video, Dara's flying into a bridge abutment in her plane.
Maybe she's walking with a Paula Poundstone-like pantsuit because it's 1982, and that's what chicks wore in videos.
They're calling this song Oh Diarrhea.
Oh, man. Let me go to Rick in El Paso. Rick!
Yeah, is this Don Docking?
I knew this was going to be bad, but this is so painful.
That's good.
To live through.
Lyrically, it's really good, though.
You
hit a lot of emotional home runs.
What was the stage outfit all about? Was it a Mike Reno thing? Where were you at? Did you have Japanese shit? Zippers, where were you?
Yeah, there were, you know, parachute pants, maybe a shirt with some Japanese lettering on it.
No headband.
But, you know, multicolored belts.
Cut off shit.
What color belts?
Yeah, like one red one, a yellow, purple, green, fucking... and one was glad. What is that?
That's
that
the song.
Joe just drove into a fucking river.
Joe's recording something right now that's better than the song. All right.
Yeah.
Nothing.
So wait.
And it's bad phone.
You had multicolored belts.
Joe, call back.
And you wear them on your thighs?
No. I would wear them around my waist, but one would be like worn like the right size.
Yeah.
And then the next one would be maybe one too loose, so it would hang on one side a little lower.
But was that how the Hulk kept his pants on when he got bigger? That's a fucking horrible idea. Five belts in case, what, you turn into Bob Kelly overnight?
They were different sized.
Yeah, they should have been. Different colors.
I don't know, this ain't bad, right?
I mean, you know, if you told me this was Duran Duran or any of those other mediocre bands, I would think, you know, I wouldn't have... It sounds, you know, recordable. I don't know.
It's but the embarrassing part is that it was ever me.
But see, what honestly, what makes it worse is that 30 years have gone by.
Yeah.
Yes. 30 fucking years have gone by.
If you were in the moment in the early 80s, okay, we'd still be beating you up, but...
If I was still trying, put it this way, if I was still trying to make it doing this music, then just fucking hang me with my multicolored belt.
That would be sad and tragic.
That would be sad.
Yeah.
But I mean, I had to search out my buddy Joe Curry to find this on a cassette tape in a box of shit, literally shit, and transfer. I mean... This shit is just part of what was going on.
Even though you were talentless, you were driven. At least you laid something down on the track.
I didn't just want to, you know, knock tin and install above the ground swimming pools.
Can I put the bat signal out for Coke Logic?
Oh, for what? Make a video?
Yeah, I think we might need a video to
if
down.
If you can make an animated.
I think we might need that there, Coke Logic.
Yeah.
Coke Logic on Twitter. Let's bother Coke Logic today.
That would roll.
We need a Dara fucking video. animation, actually.
Yeah. A little more Dara. This is good.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Only halfway through the song.
Oh, thank God.
Jesus. Yeah. Anything.
Send it my way. We could have a fine romance.
Fine.
How's your romance?
Fine. Yeah. That was the original title of the movie with that Tarantino wrote. Fine romance.
Oh, God.
Yeah. You know what
you're
you are?
Killing me.
You are a drip. What a wet
drip.
End.
Oh, God damn.
That's your romance.
This
I
really
corrected
is.
Him.
You know, Dara's close to 60, probably.
Whatever. Yeah. Who gives a
the
shit?
Busted valise now
50s.
Somewhere, yeah.
With no teeth.
Yeah.
Goes, in a fucking trailer park
you're
somewhere.
You're going to Hollywood, dog.
I've heard better sands in a... Better sounds in a paint toilet.
Dara became a hoarder.
Yes.
I picture people with mullets and fanny packs dancing to this.
Yeah. Anyone who's been dumped by a girl named Dara is really, this is going to resonate.
Oh, God. Look, I fucking warned you that it was really bad.
Too bad it wasn't 40 years earlier. You could have been singing Oh Clara. Maybe Phil Rizzuto would have signed up. Since that was his stupid wife's name. How many times are we going to hear that in a fucking Yankee broadcast? Boo, Phil.
Oh, God. This is so bad. I can't take it.
It's guess... only proper that you suffer.
I guess that's it.
I'm joking.
I liked it.
Oh, no, there's more.
Oh, fuck. I get one. Yeah. Oh, no. Now the refrain. Now I'm just crying. Stop it!
Why?
Is this where we got to get our lighters out?
Yeah. Are you singing with a clenched fist and your eyes closed, all
eyes
fucking
closed,
emotional?
And I have the mic stand rocked back at about a 45-degree angle.
Oh, God, horrible.
I'm clenching my fist and fucking like,
Oh, God.
Oh, Dara.
You smarmy bag of douche. It's horrible. It's
you never met Dara.
Fuck Dara. I know.
There is no Dara. She's some drunk trying to get into a club.
Danny just put up the final scene of the Breakfast Club.
Yeah.
Yeah, with the fist raised in the air.
How awful was that?
Oh, speaking of awful, my opening act this weekend, John O'Rourke. Johnny Up. No, a very fine performer. He's on the bill with
me. He'll be singing Dara.
I promised him a plug. He will be singing Dara.
I'm telling you, Otto and George comics at Foxwoods tonight, tomorrow, and Saturday. Five shows Otto's doing up there at foxwoods.com.
Let's just try to keep the salty language to a minimum.
Yeah,
I don't go for that.
Yeah.
More?
Oh, God.
False ending. 80s false ending.
Yeah.
Stay tuned for the drums. It wasn't enough.
All right.
Oh, God.
Pause that, please. I just heard what that was. Send your love my way. I'm sure we'd have a fine romance.
Yeah.
I'd have more respect for you if you said, take out your cock. I'm going to drop my underpants.
Someone's saying, in this day and age, I should sing O'Hara's. That was a good one. I missed your name. Sorry.
Oh, my God.
O'Hara's.
O'Hara's.
Oh,
the instant feedback and the Twitter is spinning like a slot machine right now. The amount of feedback coming in is...
I told you.
Can't even keep up with it.
I warned you. I prefaced it, and still... I can't take it. I am fucking so hot.
You were back then, too, with lyrics like that. I'll say, though, honestly, though, like, if she had sent her romance his way, honestly, it probably would have been a fine romance if Dara.
Jimmy!
Why?
You can be
celebrating your 30th wedding anniversary with Dara.
Yeah.
With a house full of fucking shit.
Yeah. And she'd see what your love was all about. You know, she sent her love your way. Because endless days equals sleepless nights.
And you're fate's really... a dealer and a fine romance.
You're really picking up on the lyrics.
Actually, Dara would have divorced you and taken all your as-is money.
My as-is cash.
That's right.
That's right.
Wonder how Dara would feel like Keith the cop fucking leaving shits in your toilet.
It worked out for you.
Wonder how Dara would feel about girls who have to be ID'd when they walk in the door. Fucking showing their clits as fucking FBI agents are coming by.
Wow. Great.
Oh, Dara, I'm sorry I came on that 14-year-old in the pool. Send your love my way. I'm a fool.
All right, you made it, man.
Is it over?
Oh, God.
Oh, Jesus.
All right.
All right.
Wow.
Oh, did you say I know it's so real?
I don't remember. Now we're freestyling.
Wait, I have a question. Because obviously you're saying it's real. And understandably that Dara should want to spend some time with you.
Yes.
Just to see how you feel. It's just shit. Why should she? Like, if a girl doesn't like you, spend some time with me. So she knows it's real. She's not interested.
Oh, I don't know.
She's fucking somebody who sings better, like Yoko Ono.
You know, Jose Feliciano, you got no complaints.
Oh, the big end.
And this is where all the guys in the band, they come on the cracker, and then the lead singer eats it, and the video fades out. So you can see how I crunch.
Oh, fuck, man.
What a delicious torture.
That...
Wow.
That was really rough. I am like fucking, I feel like I've just worked out. I am, I'm tired.
Oh, God.
I'm sweaty, and I'm on the brink of anxiety.
Fireman ran back into Tower 2.
Holy shit!
Playing in the courtyard, Dara.
Anything to get away from that? Jesus. Otto and George will be at Comics at Foxwoods tonight, tomorrow, and Saturday. Yeah, Foxwoods.com.
That song was so bad, everybody's going to Egypt now.
Oh, Chip. I can't even make fun of Chip.
Why? I knew a girl named Dara.
Yeah?
Well, you've got that to fall back on now, which is good.
Which is nice.
Well, now that's part of radio history. It's now out there in the fucking ether.
Jimmy, tomorrow? Do we hear yours?
Oh, yeah. Mine is... The reason I didn't bring mine today is I was wondering, because the interview that I did, we already played on the show. It's my first stand-up set from 96.
Oh, I'm sure you were great.
Oh.
Was it awful?
Awful.
You recorded your very first
show? No. I started in 1990. My first TV set.
Oh.
But it's back when I was like, I just came out. I was like, I feel sexy. Like, I was still kind of a character, but not as much as I had been in the 93
feel.
Okay. Sexy.
We got to play it tomorrow.
You cringe at the sight of this, the performance?
It makes his fucking Dara... It look that looks like McCartney's Super Bowl performance compared to my fucking stand-up tape.
Wow, that was fucking painful to listen to.
It was, really.
I got to be honest with you. That was very painful to listen to.
It was of the time. You know, you were.
That's the only thing I could fucking take away from it.
What year was that? 1950 douche?
That was the 80s, man.
Yeah, sure was.
That was the 80s, man.
Wow. What a decent voice, you know, just to fucking rhyme anything
so
with Dara.
Okay. Why?
Yeah, how
why?
About Tamara? I'll call you Tamara.
I'll call you Tamara, Dara.
Yeah.
I never had a chance, though.
God.
Unless she sent a love my... Because I'm sure we would have had a fine romance.
Sure.
Ugh. What the hell was I thinking?
I have diabetes from hearing that.
No, that was just...
Wow. What do you do after that?
That was... Jeez.
Shame on you.
Yeah. I don't know what to say. That was it. I was part of my
life. Did you do a lot of gigs with that group? Or
Yeah. We actually did do a lot of gigs. We did a lot of covers, which I think, you know, that's what people wanted to hear.
Yeah. What were you covering?
You know, you always got to inject your originals in there so you can make it, man.
What were some of your covers in that time? Do you remember?
Jesus Christ.
Joanna.
I don't even fucking remember.
Sarah.
Did you have a long, Sarah, long right? hair and everything, like a rock guy?
I had a big, like, big fucking afro.
Oh, shit.
Fucking crazy.
Yeah, he looked like a real creep.
Yes, and I was.
All your covers should have just been girl name songs, just one after another.
Yeah. Every shuck, Chuck, has his sensitive side of cigars and scotch.
You know what you are, though, honestly? Yeah. A jerk.
I was a sap. Just a sap.
You really were a fucking, just a maudlin drip.
I wonder how many times we must have just been in the studio rehearsing that.
But to think that, like,
and
the
recording
that you'd have a fine romance, she wasn't interested.
But if she only would have known.
Yeah, this is real.
Jimmy. Hello, Jimmy can just pluck a song apart and just make it shit.
Girl over the house, You know how that goes, right? When you're a single, successful guy, like me working at the burger place. So, girl over the house, And apparently she has asthma. She got asthma.
Oof.
Out of nowhere.
I'll give you asthma. You get dressed, you're playing golf today.
Are you dating?
What about my asthma? I'll give you asthma.
Are you dating preemies at this point? Their lungs aren't fully developed?
No. That's not. No. No.
Do you have an incubator in your fucking compound?
No, I don't have an incubator.
It's probably not asthma. It's probably just gasping at your political ideologies.
Well, that's true. They just smell me all. No, no.
You're dating so young, their lungs aren't fully developed.
No, it's not like that. It's
sorry.
Just it's asthma.
It's asthma.
And
I'll give you asthma.
And it's just gotten kind of worse over the past couple of days.
Well, that's not good.
So, you know, she hasn't been able to go back home. You know, she lives out of state. She hasn't been able to go back home.
Thailand?
And no, not Thailand. So, last night, it was time to go. I haven't gotten any sleep, by the way. I'm exhausted. I'm tripping over myself. Had to take her to the emergency room. My favorite place to go.
What time?
To take her. This was about 1:30 in the morning.
Were you asleep?
No. No, I was still awake because, you know, the asthma.
The Yankees won and stuff.
Like that and things, you know. It's, yeah. It's just one of those things. So it was time to, you know, go to the emergency room.
How far do you live from the hospital?
It's not far. It's okay. A few exits. Not bad. So we go there and, you know, you'd go through that, all that paperwork stuff. That, she, you know, she's going through all the paperwork and everything like that. It takes forever. And then
is she going through the, because this fucking frustrates the shit out of me.
Yeah.
Is she filling out her paperwork as she's gasping for air?
Well, she's not gasping for air.
Because the emergency room is wonderful when it comes to that. Make sure the paperwork is done before we even acknowledge that you're dying right in front of our eyes.
I know. It really
is.
When
I had the worst allergy attack of my life where I really thought I was like minutes from dying, they had to make sure I had all my fucking paperwork. I had a pounding headache. My headache was so bad. Sorry, Anthony, but it drives me fucking nuts. I couldn't even see the form anymore. That's how bad I was. And I'm like, will you just take care of this, and then we'll worry about the stupid paperwork.
Oh, no, they want to know your
But they need the paperwork immediately. But
they want to know they're getting paid, motherfucker.
Sorry, it's one of my fucking pet peeves in this world, the stupid emergency room and their dumb paperwork first.
Filling out the paperwork.
Sorry,
so
up,
No, they're filling out the paperwork. Then it's time to, you know, go into the emergency room portion of the hospital. Now I've you know dealt with that before in the past, this was a little embarrassing. They took her into pediatrics.
Oh my God.
Do you know there's a whole nother emergency room for pediatrics?
Oh my God.
And they brought her in there, and there's little paintings on the walls and paper ducks and stuff all over the place.
I can't even look at
And there's
you.
Little kids walking around. And a baby was crying, and she's in pediatrics, and the doctor asked me, like, you know, oh, okay, who are you? And I'm just like, a friend. I'm a friend. I've never felt like the creep that I know I am, but I've never actually felt it.
Who are you? A friend.
I'm a friend. I'm a friend.
I've never even seen that part of a hospital.
And I'm sitting in this little chair.
Right.
And I'm looking at, like, a child's rights in the hospital. And it says things like, please tell me if it's going to hurt. I'll be okay with it. And please give me a hug. I could use it. Let me take my toy wherever I'm going in the hospital. I'm reading signs like this and looking at paper fucking mobiles of ducks and geese.
All right. You know, you brought this to the show. So
I
now
know.
You just threw yourself under the
it
bus.
It was so embarrassing.
Eric at Virginia Tech. Wow, a pediatric and a geriatric.
A pediatric. And I noticed there was a cabinet with games in it, all kinds of games. Oh. I'm in the fucking pediatric ward. And you know, the girl there, she's tall. And her feet were hanging off of the end of the friggin' pediatric bed. I felt so bad. And I felt like such a ghoul.
Just because they're tall doesn't make it okay, Anthony.
No, I understand. I understand.
Did you take advantage of the situation and get some speed dating in while they were running her through the tests?
There was one girl that got up and she's holding the back of her gown shut and she had to be about 16 or 17. to go give a urine sample. She was pretty cute, yeah. I must say. But, you know, I put my head down the whole time. I just felt like...
Were you ashamed and embarrassed?
Dude, I was completely ashamed and embarrassed.
You're a celebrity.
Yeah.
Finally, you were ashamed.
It finally took...
It's not bad for you to have a little shame, finally.
To go to the emergency room...
Yeah.
...and have a girl that's been, you know, staying at the house because she's sick and can't, you know, can't make it back home in that state with the asthma and stuff.
Did you just pay cash?
Pediatrics.
Did you just pay cash for the...
She's insured. She's got insurance.
Did she have to call her daddy for her insurance number?
No, she's got insurance. But it's like...
What the fuck?
It's like pediatrics. So then they actually admitted her. Mm-hmm. And they didn't put her in the regular room wing. And now she's in the pediatrics part of the hospital. So not only the emergency room is pediatric, but she's in a pediatric room, which can only mean when I do go there, she's probably sharing the room with some child in a,
with some child with a broken leg. The first broken bone.
It's just, it really is. I've never felt so ghoulish in my life.
Well, let's start with this. Tony in Iowa, very good question. Did she get a sticker after her boo-boo was gone?
Boo-boo. No, there wasn't a giraffe gurney, a giraffe hippopotamus monkey gurney.
Yeah, Eric, once again for Virginia Tech, kind of reworking my line, but it's true. Just because she doesn't have to be on her tippy toes doesn't make it okay.
It's... did they give her a lollipop after she let... No. But, oh, look at, there's a castle gurney. It's like you're in the castle. Like you're a little princess in a castle. Thank you, Danny, for popping up these embarrassing pictures.
Then some curmudgeon has to point out princesses don't have catheters.
Kevin from Connecticut, and you were actually in the pedo-atric ward.
No, look at that picture. Danny's the worst. It's a little kid in a hospital gown that's dragging on the floor.
You know they said that girl's father is creepy when they saw you.
No, because that's the worst. That's another bad part, too, because they have to ask her all bunch of questions, and I guess they asked her if she was sexually active, and, you know, she had to say yes, and then...
Why do they want to know that?
Somehow I got brought into the conversation.
Why do they want to know
that? They always ask, you know, people in pediatrics that, you know. And then I think they asked her if her parents knew.
Did you get some creepy looks? Let's be honest. Let's get right to it. What were the looks you were getting?
Yeah, I think the doctor was giving me some really creepy looks, and the nurses and stuff didn't even want to acknowledge I was there. They
Why would they? You're
like,
a filthy shock jock.
You fucking scum of the earth. You horrible child spoiler. That's what
Stephen,
I was.
Stephen S. from Bayshore. I hope whoever... Ah, fuck. It's feedback. Forget it. Everybody wants in on this one.
Yeah.
I hope whoever was working the desk recognized Ant and put her in pediatrics just to fuck with him.
No, they put her right in there.
Wow.
Pediatric. There's nothing... I've never been so mortified.
Were you embarrassed?
At being with a younger lady than when she had to be admitted to pediatrics. Yes. And I've been in some weird situations where, of course, there'd be, you know, hey, that must be, your dad or something. Yeah. That's never good, but I get a good laugh out of that. Who cares? But pediatrics. Oh, yes. She is, of age. Definitely. I was wondering the same thing. Like, why admit somebody of that age?
I think because pediatrics includes the 18th year.
Does it?
Yeah, I remember when I was 18, and I was when I went to the doctor, I still had to go to the pediatrician at 18, and I felt so embarrassed because, like, I'm sitting there and there's kids' toys, you know, where they play with those beads that go along the wire track, and I'm sitting there like, why am I here? Like, I'm wearing a Metallica T-shirt, and I'm like, come on,
drunkenly playing with an abacus.
You're in pediatrics.
Scott from Quakertown, so now you have to go pick her up from Child Protective Services today, Ed?
No.
Do you have to sit with a DIFUS counselor with your chick?
Look, she's completely of age, an adult. Yeah, but, you know, for some reason, they put her in pediatrics.
Let's go to Chris in PA. Chris.
Hey, Ann, did you guys sit at the little Lego table and build your future dream house together?
She likes Legos.
I love Legos.
What am I going to do?
Wow.
You know. Well,
I just, are you, whoa, are you okay?
I just feel bad because, you know, she's in there and, you know.
Are you okay if I take that phone call? I can't believe I'm using restraint.
I can't see with the thing in the way. It's
that would be burp.
Oh, my God. No, that's horrible.
All right. Jeez, I got to show some restraint.
Girls in the hospital.
It was a burp joke. All right. Yeah. Well, thank you.
I don't want to make fun, but it's just, actually, I'm not making fun of the fact that, you know, she has bad asthma and she went into the hospital. I'm making light of the fact that I am such a fucking god awful creep and to finally see it staring back at me in the mirror.
She's still in there? She all right?
Yeah, she's still in there. You know, they gotta make sure, you know, they do tests and everything and see what kind of medication works better. Cause she's got, you know, the inhaler and stuff like that. But,
right.
But, yeah, that's not doing the trick. So,
Brian in Texas. Brian.
Yeah, and were you kind of worried that you might bump into one of your exes there?
In pediatrics?
Oh.
I mean, you're being a repeat offender and all, you know.
Oh, my God.
Repeat offender. I never date underage girls.
Well.
Well, not.
That's right.
Not now.
You know you're fucking playing with fire when before you go away you have to check the state laws?
Yes. Yes, it is. You got to make sure, you know, but.
Mm-hmm. Jesus. Some of these guys are going brutal with this. Fucking uncomfortably brutal.
Well, I didn't expect pediatrics. That threw me for a bit of a loop.
Yeah.
But I got to tell you, no crowd. They get right to you. It's pretty good. We had to walk through. We had to walk through the regular emergency room area to get to the pediatric one, and there's some woman yelling. But what's her blood pressure? Like some, I guess some woman and her mother were there, and the mother's some old bag, and she's in there with you know, getting her blood pressure taken, and this woman's yelling at a nurse, and she goes, "You asked me three times already, and I told you." Well, what is it? And it's just like pandemonium, and then we go into pediatrics, and it's like. Oh, this is nice.
Wow.
There's only a few rooms. There's no commotions going on. Everyone's nice.
But why is a person who's of age legally, why are they asking, does your family know if you're sexually active?
I don't know.
She's old enough. I know how old she is. She's old enough legally
to join
the military, to be executed in every state. I don't think
they were asking, does your family know if you're sexually active? I think they were asking, does your family know that... You're with an old ghoul.
But again, that's none of their fucking business. She's a legal adult.
Well, it certainly isn't.
None of their fucking business.
You know, I guess they wanted to know if I was, you know.
Again, none
of them. They wanted to satisfy their own curiosity.
Yeah, that's all that is.
Yeah. Mm. Boy, that really did kind of.
Teddy from New York writes, right now she's talking to the social worker, and they're asking her to show them where the bad man touched her.
Shut the fuck up. And no, I didn't take her there in a car seat. You fucking people.
Let's say hi to Scott in Chattanooga.
Show us on the doll where he touched.
Yeah, Scott, Chattanooga.
Hey, while you were waiting, did you get caught up on all those SpongeBob episodes you missed?
No, there wasn't SpongeBob on the TV.
Nice.
There aren't many pediatric patients at that hour in the morning for some reason. You know, I guess kids ain't up.
Yeah.
They're sleeping. Taking a little baby aspirin or something, and they're fine until the morning. But I do have to, you know, get back there at some point to the whole pediatric ward now I go into. I get to walk in there and... be a complete creep all over again.
Hi. I can picture Anthony saying hi, like peeking in the window. Hi. Embarrassed and kind of creepy.
The roommate kid starts crying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you had a rusher there in the middle of the night?
Well, it wasn't like a rush job, you know. It wasn't like that, but, you know, you get a little concerned.
Sure.
So, yeah. Yeah.
Asthma sucks.
Yeah.
People want to know if she brought her blankie.
They give them blankies there, thank you very much.
Well, she probably wants her blankie. Psychotic writes, did Chris Hansen tell you to take a seat in the waiting room to have some lemonade and a cookie?
That is horrible.
So you've come to the emergency room. Why don't you sit down? All right, you're free to go. The cops put their knee in my neck in the hallway.
Let's say hi to Larry King. Larry!
Morning.
Morning, Larry.
Hey, Anthony, how important is the age of consent?
Very. Very important.
So the nurses... Are you sure? Nobody would talk to you?
No, they kind of talk to me.
Yeah.
Standoffishly. I was sitting in the room at one point when the doctor came in, and he goes, well, we're just going to, you know, ask her a few questions. Who are you? And I said, I'm a friend. And he goes, all right, you'll have to step out of the room. And I had to get up and just kind of skulk out of the room like a fucking...
Is that the way it would be, though, with anyone or no?
Guy. I would guess so, unless the most family.
For the most part,
you know,
they say that.
Especially in pediatrics. It's horrible. Anthony Polanski.
Let me say hi to Corinne in Jersey.
When Ant walked into pediatrics, did the whole staff yell, Norm! Anthony Glitter. All right. Yes.
Let's go to Corinne in Jersey. Corinne.
Ant, I want to know, did you take her to, are you going to take her to Toys R Us when she gets discharged for being such a brave big girl?
Yes. Yes. I'm going to do that.
And Corinne knows how to call a radio show. She's gone. Let me say hi to your favorite therapist.
Oh, no.
Lydia from Oceanside.
Oh, Christ.
Hello, Lydia.
Hi, boy.
You're
hi,
laughing today.
Lydia.
You're laughing today, aren't you, Lydia?
What's my problem now, Lydia?
Well, let's listen in. Lydia knows a thing or two about creeps. Go ahead, Lydia.
I've been really trying to lay off Anthony. I let the panic room go. All the dreams, the drunken Halloween party. Mm-hmm. But you yourself said that maybe you needed to look at your life.
No, I didn't say that. I said I felt like a creep. Do I really care? Yeah, not really. Once I was out of there, I was fine. It's just being in there is a little awkward, you know, because it's pediatrics.
But Anthony's not doing anything wrong by dating somebody younger. There's nothing wrong with that. That's who he likes to date.
Yeah.
There is nothing wrong with being with someone younger. Absolutely not. There is something wrong with avoiding people of a certain age because you can't connect with people on an adult level.
Yeah, so? I can't. I don't like people my own age. They're stupid and not fun.
Yeah.
But you're about to spend your own age.
You know what was really odd? Being in there and they started, like, in the triage area, they took our blood pressure. And I was like, I was just talking today about the blood pressure thing being around my heart on.
That's right.
You should have told
and
them
there
that.
It was. Yeah, that would have upped the creep factor. You know, let me tell you a cute little dream I had last night.
Just only a mere few days ago.
But it was so odd. No, it was that day.
You're right.
I was talking about it, and then there I was looking at the blood pressure thing going, wow, that's a weird coincidence.
Yep.
I haven't seen one of those in a while, and there I am right there looking at that.
Well, what do you got, Lydia? Anything else? You're not really delving into this one.
I guess I want to tell Anthony not to talk about the dreams in the panic room when he takes his young girlfriend to the ER because the psych ER is probably right next door.
Oh, don't even worry about it. I'm fine mentally.
There's nothing wrong with an older man liking young broads because he doesn't want to connect with an older broad. There's nothing wrong with that.
All they do is fucking bitch and complain.
Every guy wishes he was you, Anthony. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I guess I'm just worried about the total picture, the panic room, the dream.
Panic room, as much as it's a gun safe, but it's big, so you know you could fit in it. It's a secure place. See, I'm being responsible. It's a secure place for firearms that is alarmed and locked with an electronic lock. And if you know, I'm in there, I would be locked in there, but I could then get out whenever I wanted to. What's wrong with that? In this day and age of crime and crime.
Well, you know, I don't want to constantly lay into you for the same old things. I just wish you would consider maybe checking out eHarmony or something like that.
eHarmony? You know what? That fucking commercial creeps me out. You ever see the one with the fucking laughing Asian girl on the beach with her dog? That has got to be the creepiest fucking bitch I've ever seen. She's looking at the camera, petting her dog on the beach, and it's black and white. And then she goes, and then to like 5 seconds later, she goes, it's like, who wants to date that fucking nut?
Well,
lunatic.
I'm
out in 15 minutes.
What the fuck's going on?
Abandoning ship.
He's got to go. He's got to go down to the Yankee store.
I got
to
go.
Get a 27.
Well, once you explain to Dane.
Get a 27.
Once you explain to Dane Cook, Bob Kelly, and Bill Burr, because they didn't hear.
I didn't know Bill Burr heard.
Oh, my God. What a hilarious.
We heard.
Why don't you tell Dane?
Oh, come on, dude.
Sorry.
What, did he fart right there?
Can you wait till I'm out of the seats? Fucking Jesus Christ.
Look at this.
It's like you're breaking up with your girl and a guy's fucking her while you're packing your suitcase.
Really, Bobby's like already in Jimmy's seat.
Where are you going?
He's got to go to a hospital.
I got to go and to check on somebody.
A friend.
And a friend.
Get their side of the story.
And you know, perhaps pick them up and you know.
He's leaving out a few details.
Are they in the hospital?
Yeah, she has like asthma.
Oh, it's a female.
Do they have cartoons on the wall?
Well, that's what we're getting at.
It was...
She's in a certain part of the hospital.
Well, I didn't know that they admit girls of that age into the pediatric ward. I had to actually sit in the pediatric emergency room.
And you had to actually say to the nurse, how do you spell colic?
Yeah, I had to sit in the pediatric emergency room as the doctor went over everything. And I let me tell you something. I've had some... Anthony, you are a fucking creep moment in my life, but that topped everything that I've ever done in my life as far as being the creepy guy. I just felt like a fucking ghoul sitting there with people looking like, okay, 18.
Just turned.
But, did it ever cross your mind to leave and say, I can't do this anymore? Like an alcoholic hitting bottom?
You can't have the chick like fucking, you know, wheezing.
Did you call anybody for help and say, what's going on with me?
No, it's like, no. What am I doing? Why? Why? It's consenting adults. I don't know why they check them into pediatrics. For the love of Christ, why the fuck?
You know what? I can't make up my mind. I can't make up my mind on this one. If that side, what Bobby's arguing, is right, or if that's just jealousy and hate that people also, like other people didn't just stay single, you know, just continue to focus on the career so you're successful enough that you can bang an 18-year-old. What are you, 62? That's like everybody trashes people
working my way through my 40s.
Dude, and what a way to go through your
through
40s.
Somebody else's 15s.
Asshole, never underage.
You like that one, Bobby?
All the state statutes. Believe me, I got it on a fucking. There's an app for that.
I really
look up Missouri. Where
can you get me a ride home from New Jersey? I'm sorry, baby, that's gonna be a problem. Let me check my phone now.
I can't go around this state.
Yeah, I can go up New York and then go to Pennsylvania.
I have to go around states. I'm the only one in like 80 years to be arrested for the Mann Act. I don't even know what it is. You transport her across state lines, boy?
In her bare feet. Yeah, it's statutory rape.
Oh, shit.
It was, it was.
That's a good
very
one.
Very embarrassing.
That's one of the better stories Anthony
has. I like
told.
How Bobby's eating here and he just tried to contribute to the show by eating and just goes, shit.
How mustard is sounding.
Yes, mustard is the one guy who's like trying to sound really good.
Yeah, he's trying.
Like, yeah.
With the affectation on his voice and the whole deal.
I just want my hair saving our own lives. It's true and I go that a day. Just you and me. We are the world. We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's start giving. Let's start giving. There's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives. It's true we make a better day. Just you and me.
It's not bad.
No,
why
it's
are you
actually
guys
not.
Faces?
Because I don't like the. I don't like the.
Grab your lunch out of the dumpster.
The affectation.
Yeah, yeah.
But, but he actually did sound good there.
There is kind of a.
It's true we make a better day. You and I. We are the way. We are the children. We are the one who made trust for make that.
Right. Fuck, what are you doing?
You're getting annoyed.
Holy shit.
Mustard's starting to...
Maybe it sounds good on the plastered walls of a shelter, but holy fuck.
Jesus, Anthony.
Enough.
Trying to help a guy.
We have a chance, we'll make it. We're saving our life. True, we'll make a better day for you and me.
Fuck. Stop it.
You're turning the corner on Mustard.
Fuck, oh, I'm done.
You had it.
Done. Why? Put it down. Why? Bring in ketchup. I've had enough of the Mustard.
Why have you had it?
Back to the fucking shelter. With you. Holy shit, that affectation, that affected fucking technique.
He's trying to show people that he's very talented.
Yeah,
even, though it's a even though it's a shit project he's involved with.
Are the one who made, we are the one who made a brighter day. Let's start giving, trust we make right. We're saving our own life. True, we make a better day. Just you and me. Hey!
You're making me uncomfortable.
Oh, I hate it. Fuck.
What's wrong with you?
Let's be behind Dunkin' Donuts and get some breakfast.
Trust we make right. Saving our own lives.
Yeah.
It's true and I go that a day. Just you and me.
My. Who's my?
We are the world. We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's start giving. Let's start giving. There's a choice we're making.
Yeah. Roof over your head or no roof over your head. You made the wrong one.
Just you and me.
Why are you turning on Mustard?
I just,
that's actually not bad. Fuck.
Yeah. Why are you turning on Mustard?
I just we are the world. We are the world. We are the children. We are the one to make a brighter day. So let's talk it all inside. There's a chance for mega. We're saving our own life. It's true. Well, I'm about to die. Just you and me. Shit.
Are you saying enough?
Oh, back to the gutter. Back to Skid Row.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
Stop it already.
When Ant has had it, he's had it.
Oh, I have had it. Go fight someone for a heating grate.
You have no fucking, you don't even have a hint of a heart.
Oh, God. Enough. Just fucking find yourself a sleeping bag, a heating grate, and a box. Hear him inside. What's coming out of that box? Sounds coming from a box. Made the wrong one, didn't you?
Jesus, happened. Anthony.
Right.
This guy's down on his luck.
Fuck. Oof. Oh, here he is.
Saving our it's true and I go that a day. Just you and me.
My.
We are the world. Oh.
We are the world. We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's talk it. So let's talk it. That's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives. It's true we make a better day. Just you and I.
Shut it! Fuck! Hate it.
Wow. Jesus, man.
I don't know.
And it is. It's a goof song. Who cares? Fucking singing it like it's the Star Spangled Banner. Like it's the fucking fucking seahorse song.
You got that down in three takes. You perfectly had that.
I fucking love it. What am I kidding?
Saving our lives. It's true. I'm about to die. It's you and me. We are the world.
We are the world.
We are the
children. We are the children.
We are the one. So let's not give up. Let's not give up. There's a choice we make up. We're saving our own lives. It's coming back up. I don't try. You and me.
Right? That fucking rat-nest beard. Enough.
You had a girlfriend, she had a boyfriend.
Lexi.
You had a girlfriend, she had a boyfriend.
Yeah.
And you take her to a big over-the-top event with a shitload of fucking paparazzi.
Yeah, well, wait a minute. I had just started going out with the wonderful Melissa Stettin at the time.
Okay.
Supermodel Melissa Stettin, as they call her on certain websites, I guess. And... So it was kind of like, I think I could get one more date in before I actually commit up to this thing.
Right.
You know?
Had you committed up?
I'm not sure. It was in that gray area.
Really?
It was in that gray area.
But I think if we asked...
She'd deny that.
Okay, I was going to say, if we asked her,
right,
it was not a gray area.
And did you say, I'm just going to bring this girl because we're not really committed yet? Or were you like, I'm going alone, don't even worry about it?
I didn't say anything, but I did find out that during a certain gray area... When we were, you know, she was flying to New York so we could hang out. And we were kind of establishing something. Gray area. When she went back to L.A. once, fucked her ex-boyfriend. So.
When did you learn that?
I don't know. It was kind of at some point. I don't know. So this girl, Lexi, who I thought, you know, a very pretty girl and stuff like that. Like, we kind of got together and she didn't say anything about a boyfriend.
Mm-hmm. Where'd you guys meet?
I might have been that wonderful vehicle called Facebook.
Facebook.
Or something.
And when you saw the paparazzi taking pictures and stuff, like Getty Image was there.
Yeah, yeah.
See, it looks on your face like you're like, well, fuck it. Let's make the most of it.
Yeah, what?
Like, I'm all in then.
Like, I was with my wife and I didn't stop for those fucking vultures.
It's a gray area.
I actually went in a side door. I'm like, I don't want to deal with that shit.
I was in
you
the
stop.
Gray.
You stop. Look, you're already.
I'm so proud. This is my date. I couldn't be more proud.
I was
nothing to hide.
When you were absolutely in gray area material.
It was a gray area. Gray area.
All right.
I was in that gray zone of fucking relationship.
They use that picture a lot, too, that one.
They do. It's a great pick, isn't
that,
it?
That one pops up
look
a
at
lot.
Us. We're just a fucking power couple out on the town.
Did you have to explain the picture?
Yes. I got a lot of heat for the picture.
You did?
A lot of heat
what
for
kind
the picture.
Of heat?
I think I got like things thrown at me.
Oh, but nothing.
Melissa, the lovely and talented Melissa Stettin was always good at picking up an object and heaving it at your buddy Anthony.
Yeah.
Oh, she was a heaver. Could she throw anything?
What kind of things were heaves at you? Could we guess?
Give it a guess.
All right. Make a list, Sam.
Okay. Right. Things that were heaved at me.
How many?
From Melissa Stettin.
How many things?
Dude. I can't count.
Oh, good. Okay. I'm going to go easy. I'm going to go beer bottle / wine bottle.
Yes.
Yes.
I was once at the receiving end of a beer bottle being thrown at me.
How about like any food products, like a sandwich or something?
No, that's too vague.
No, because you want to see it like the idea of like a sandwich falling apart as it hits Anthony. That's like funny.
By the way, if anyone's wondering.
No food.
I got this shitty fucking voice from Sam Roberts. Sam Roberts got me sick. He came in here fucking sick.
And I got this wonderful voice from Opie Fees.
See how that works? No.
I'm gonna food.
Right.
I'm going to go with an iPhone.
Yes, yeah, multiple,
two for two.
Multiple times I have all had right. my various phones
now I want to keep my
thrown at me.
I want to keep my streak alive, yeah, so I got to be very well. Careful right here.
Yeah, yeah.
How about a hairbrush?
Hairbrush. Yes, I have had hairbrushes thrown at me by Stetton. Yes, yes.
Shit. Mm-hmm. Oh, mm-hmm. fuck. All right. Mm-hmm.
Ah! Ah!
Remote control.
Oh, yeah!
Three for three.
The remote control from the TV did take flight.
I'm going very safe right now.
Yes, you are.
Three for three.
I'll take some of the risks. How about like an empty bucket or a pail?
No.
You just think it'd be funny to watch somebody throw a bucket?
It would be funny. And there is indeed a bucket in the slop sink in the laundry room. So it wouldn't be out of the question
right.
that perhaps you would have found something in the laundry room, a pair of panties, a brassiere, gotten angry with me, picked up a bucket and thrown it at me. This did not happen.
Okay.
I'm going to go with another safe one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
A glass.
A glass. Yes, yeah. I did
four
have
for four.
A glass thrown at me. It did hit the back of the couch.
Okay.
And did not break. That was in the living room.
Is there still more possibilities?
Oh, yeah.
Because I don't want my streak to...
Okay. Oh, there's, all right.
I'm
there's,
four for four. More.
I'll keep up with the crazy ones.
Uh-huh.
Chair.
No. Okay. No, that's pretty big.
Yeah, yeah. I was just thinking.
That's a big one. And that's a hint right there. It was never anything as large as a chair.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They're playing along at home here. Ninja stars. No.
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 Live grenade.
Live grenade. No. Oh, no. Okay, yeah. Racial epithets.
You know, this is all right. Yeah. I'm going to keep my streak alive. I'm hoping.
Uh-huh.
A shoe.
Oh, come on.
All right. I'm five for five.
Of course. A shoe.
Five for five.
A shoe. Yes.
Okay.
Keys.
Yes, keys. Right. I did have keys.
Is there a wild one?
You're
in there?
Not going anywhere, Karen.
Is there a wild one in there?
A wild one,
like something you would just never think, something expensive.
Yeah, there was. Yes, something.
All right,
more expensive than the iPhone.
Probably on par with.
No, I don't take my guess. Okay. This could wreck my streak, but I'm going to go with it.
Uh-huh.
An iPad.
Ruins the streak. Sorry. Oh,
fuck.
Never had the iPad thrown at me. But no. There was a camera.
A yes. video camera? Or
a video camera. Okay. Yeah, was thrown at me.
Plate of spaghetti's coming in. Plate of spaghetti.
Nah, plate of spaghetti.
What about a the remains of an abortion?
Thank God, no. Ange checking in. Of course, my personal assistant, Ange. Melinda throwing the glass at you in the hot tub trumps Melissa's objects.
Wow, why?
It is true.
Why?
Well, the danger factor of a glass being thrown in the jacuzzi is very high.
Wait, meaning you're only a few feet away?
Yes, I was on one side of the jacuzzi. Melinda was on the other side, and she picked up a glass and threw it right at my face. I pulled a superhero move in that short period of time, lifted my hand up, fook, just grabbed the glass in midair.
Nice.
And summarily threw her out of the jacuzzi and my house.
So fucking badass.
When she talked about
crazy.
It, she talked about that on our show, right?
Yeah.
She was a little like, she felt like she was in a weird gray area and thinking that she was falling for you again a little bit, right?
It was, it was very odd. She,
started hanging out again.
It was very weird, for Melinda. She was insane. Yes. Very strange. Very, quite a reach.
It's that goddamn Kumia charm.
It must be.
What else has been thrown at you?
And how many of the items
finish out the list.
Hit you?
Huh?
How many of them hit you? Like, there's a lot that you avoided or that you caught.
Let me tell you something. The only one that actually hit me was the first thing that was ever thrown at me by her.
The beer.
Then I was onto it.
The beer bottle.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't. iPhone was the first thing that was thrown at me. Because the iPhone was the reason that I got something thrown at me. Anthony was very trusting and had no code on his iPhone. He was at a hotel room in Manhattan with Melissa Stetton, wonderful supermodel, as they say on websites. And I left my phone out on the night table as I went in to take a little shower. And my shower was interrupted, mind you. Thank God I wasn't in the shower still. I was drying off.
But nude?
No, I had a towel around me. And the door flings open and I hear, "You motherfucking piece of shit," as the phone came flying in at me.
Wow.
Where did it hit you?
It hit me square in the side of the head.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah, and then it tumbled to the floor.
Broken iPhone?
And cracked, yeah. Mm. Yeah, and then I'm like, you know, you get that Rolodex of what did I do? Going through my head. I'm like, uh-oh, the phone. Yeah.
You don't want to fess up to anything yet because you can't fess up to what she hasn't found out about.
Right. Mm. Well, she had taken a peek at my phone.
She took a little look-see.
Perhaps saw some.
Anthony Cumia, very trusting, not to be trusted.
You know what? Don't go through my shit.
Right.
That's what I say.
Right.
Don't go through my shit.
Right.
And you fucking, fucked your boyfriend.
Right.
Your ex-boyfriend.
Wow. You threw that right back at her.
Hey, you know, you got to do that.
You got to do what you got to do.
You got to do that.
What else makes the list?
Perhaps there was some fondling going on in the jacuzzi with a certain fucking guy from a television show.
No.
What television show?
I'm not saying.
In your jacuzzi.
I'm not even speculating. I'm not even going off on that. My jacuzzi.
Write the TV show down.
Oh.
I bet I can guess the TV show. I won't. This.
Perhaps this was going on.
In your house?
Uh-huh.
And you No way.
A very drunken night.
No way.
Oh, yeah. There's been accusations that were going on
Why don't you just ask?
Oh, I did.
And what?
Oh, there was that made a giant, as they say, a boudel. That was a giant, big blowout thing of accusations, denials, witnesses.
No, you asked. Whoa. You asked her.
Yeah.
Why don't you ask him?
I did.
And what did he say?
I did. No, there was never any recollection of anything, and everything was drunk.
Where
and
were you?
Vague. I was probably fucking tonguing some whore that was over my house in the basement.
Oh my!
No,
God.
I have no idea. So I wasn't there.
Where did it get to the point where the allegations started?
Actually, later in that evening, when a couple of key witnesses said they saw things that were a little shady going on in the jacuzzi. And I'm like, what?
Didn't you check your security cameras?
I tried, but they weren't focused on that.
Yeah. And how's your relationship with this guy?
Oh, it's fine. Because I don't give a shit.
Right.
After that point.
But there was a denial.
Not total denial. There was a Reagan testimony. I don't recall.
I don't recall.
Yes, wow. I don't recall. There was a lot of drinking.
Right.
Believe me, a lot of drinking. And yeah.
Right under your nose.
But right after that event,
right,
Anthony entered this renaissance, this new phase of I don't give a shit.
Right, all fucks were forgotten.
And I just fucking, I got a naughty boy phone. I put a fucking block on it. I used to hide my naughty boy phone under my mattress on my side of the bed. And I was texting, DMing, fucking everything you could do with every girl I could possibly fucking find.
Because of this allegation?
That was a big part of it.
That started it?
That was a big part of it.
How early on was this allegation?
It was about halfway through the whole deal. And then it just like I'd given up on the relationship, but it was one of those things where it's kind of hard to instantly get out of.
Yeah.
And I tried, if you recall, remember the stories, she was out of the house, living in my apartment in Manhattan.
Right.
But out of the house. Hmm. And she moved over to LA and, you know, that's that. But
and you guys are good now, right?
There's still little snippy things going back and forth, but nothing, you know,
nothing too major,
nothing too bad. There's an occasional text of like, oh, did you see that? Or did you see this kind of thing? But yeah, I don't hold any grudges. Why would I?
Two sides to every story indeed.
Well, let's finish our list though. So far, things thrown at Anthony in this relationship was a beer bottle, an iPhone, a hairbrush, remote control, drinking glass, shoe, keys, video camera. Anything else to add to that list?
There was trying to think.
Had to be some kind of food.
How long was the relationship?
Never food.
Relationship is probably your standard year, relationship year.
5, 6, 7, 8. So you're looking at something getting thrown at you almost monthly.
Yes, okay. It was usually a monthly thing.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So did you have a pumpkin thrown at you? Any
holiday?
Any holiday things thrown at you?
A cornucopia.
A Christmas ball.
A fucking M80.
A turkey leg. An Easter egg.
Right. A handful of candy corn.
A flag for Flag Day. Anything? Anything else to add to the list?
Yeah, I'm trying to think of things that were around the... Yeah, I'm kind of drawing a blank now. There were probably a couple of other stray items, but nothing really of note.
Okay.
Anything, she could get her hands on during a moment of anger, I guess.
So I almost was perfect.
Yeah, you came close.
Except for that iPad.
I had to go
guess.
iPad.
Got a little overzealous.
I was thinking like a Frisbee toss.
Yeah. I hear you.
Oh, well.
Yeah, so, but that Lexi girl, that's what we got. That Lexi girl from the Paul McCartney concert was one of those things where I was like, you know what? I, as a matter of fact, the reason I didn't take Melissa Stettin, she was out of town. What am I going to do? Go fucking solo?
It was the big Paul McCartney night.
I'm going to go solo to Paul McCartney? Or I'm going to take the likes of fucking Travis Teft or Sam Roberts?
No.
I don't think so. I got Getty fucking photos there. I need a little arm candy. Right?
The media would think you were a queeb.
Or a quay.
Or a quay, right.
Right. Mm. Not me, motherfucker. So, and then the fucking turnabout is fair play. There was some kind of Facebook scandal where all of a sudden I get this big fucking Facebook thing from her boyfriend.
Uh-oh.
Saying, hey, dude, you're fucking going out with my girlfriend.
Jesus.
We're going out. We're boyfriend and girlfriend, you fuck.
You really didn't know?
Not a clue.
He was pissed.
He was fucking pissed.
So she's in
the media's got our pictures out there.
But she's in a solid relationship.
Apparently
this
guy thought, and even if it's not, you don't want to go in there with a guy in a relationship.
So
but trouble.
Let's break this down. You go to Paul McCartney with her.
Yeah.
The pictures are taken and they're splashed everywhere. Yeah. And then he finds out. So then he gets a hold of you.
Yeah, he wrote some big Facebook posty thing.
To you directly?
That's just it. I wasn't really going on Facebook much at that point. So I didn't really see it, but other people did, and they copy-pasted it. And said, what is this going on? What the fuck?
Can we find it?
Good luck.
What did he say?
He was just like, hey, it's my chick. We're going out. What are you doing?
Right.
He's like, oh, I can't compete with that.
Which, bummed out.
It's absolutely the truth. I mean, really, think about it, people.
Yeah, but that's the way to win the heart of his girl back.
Can't compete with that. So did he say sorry?
Said anything. I think
you just let it go away.
She actually texted me after that and was like, hey, sorry about this whole thing. What are you going to do? I got me one of them boyfriends and I was like, all right.
Was she hoping that you were going to be her boyfriend?
I don't know. I don't know. She was cool. Nice, fun kind of a thing. But
good looking.
What are you going to do? Yeah. She's very attractive.
One of those whirlwind gray area romances.
So he goes, oh, it's high pitched Anthony voice.
Why don't you do a dramatic reenactment of a dice conversation with Kenny in 1991?
91?
Hey, Kenny, throw this guy out of here. I'm trying to eat my butterfly filet mignon. Hey, waiter, butterfly.
Did you see him on that Trump show?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, for the one episode. They should have had him on for the whole thing.
I know.
They should have had him on. That's so stupid.
He didn't help us.
He was acting up.
Yeah. I know, that's what you want.
You don't make the cupcakes. He said, I'm from Brooklyn. We don't make cupcakes.
Make cupcakes.
Just make the cupcakes so you can be on the show a while.
I'm not going to sit here and make cupcakes. All right, Donnie Trump. Hey, Donnie Trump, why don't you bring some bagels?
Oh, he was yelling at Donnie for the bagels.
Yeah.
There was a time we went to dinner with him, and he got the butterfly fucking filet mignon,
And the waiter, he was he had this poor motherfucker running around.
Which way?
Which way? Medium or well done? All right. Medium? Yeah! You're like, what the fuck are you talking about? So the poor guy comes up, he goes, Dice goes, I want a baked potato, and I want the skin rolled around on the grill. So it's golden brown. Because, you hear me?
Remember?
Because he's here like, it's like the half Italian bully and the half like Jewish kvetching customer at the restaurant.
That's exactly what he is. So the waiter comes over and brings this shit, and I guess the potato wasn't rolled around on the grill. And believe me, they brought this shit out so fucking fast to keep Dice happy. And then he's like, excuse me, the potato... Do you remember when you were here before? Do you remember when I told you? He's talking about it like it was years ago, and the guy had ordered like fucking 5 minutes before. Do you even remember? And all I'm thinking is everything is getting loogies.
Yeah.
Just fucking clams are being spit on everything. Mine and the whole table.
Yes.
The guy's jerking off the fucking, the fucking hollandaise sauce has just come.
Yeah.
What is this? Excuse me.
Right, and then his steak was undercooked.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was undercooked, and then he wanted it butterfly. He gets the butterfly, and then goes, now it's too well done.
He sent the steak back, no joke, 3 or 4 times.
Yeah. Yeah.
To the point where everyone was around the grill, because the grill was in the open. They're all in a circle staring at the steak and making a decision, like, I think this might do it this time.
Wow. Did they have to throw away, like, 3 steaks? Everything.
He had everyone in a complete panic. Not one guy telling him to shut the fuck up.
And I think even when he got the steak, they asked him how it was, and he goes, yeah, it'll do.
Right.
He wasn't even happy with it.
But he was, though.
And then he ordered the dessert, the chocolate moussey dessert thing that takes like a half hour.
The lava cake.
And then he's telling everybody, okay, don't touch it. Everybody, take a spoonful. Now shut your eyes and just taste. And he shuts his eyes and he's like, and I'm like, I'm dining with a fucking retard. It's fucking retarded. Shut your eyes. How old are you?
The spoon falls out of his hand because he can't take it.
It's delicious. Now open your mouth. Here comes the airplane. No, don't feed me, Dice. I'm feeding you. Choo-choo. Choo-choo.
And then we went sweatshirt shopping.
Oh, yeah.
But he insisted we get double XLs.
XL, well, Everlast.
I was never able to wear my sweatshirt.
No.
And it was a nice sweatshirt. It was just the wrong size.
It was giant.
By a lot.
Yeah. I remember it was a close. Fucking Snuggie.
Oh, you were annoying him because you were walking around and he was kind of... You kept going, oh, my God, Andrew Dice Clay. Oh, my God, it's Dice.
It's Times Square.
And he was like... He didn't want people bothering him.
No.
No matter... Like, we would walk another 30 feet and he'd go, oh, my God, Dice, it's
Is
Dice.
That Dice?
Is that Dice? Yeah, he was really irritating because people kept approaching him.
Dice, I'm a large, not a double XL. No, you got to get the double XL.
So you want thing, this
that,
one.
That thing sat in my dresser for years. I couldn't wear it
and
once.
And he's haggling like he's in a market in Bangladesh with the fucking guy. It's Times Square, and he's there, you know, I'll give you 25 for it. No, it's fucking, the price is the price here. We're in America, dummy. Not some rolling fucking market in Iraq.
The best fucking Dice discount was when he got a video camera cheaper, and he told me the way he got it cheaper was he walked up to the guy, and he goes, you got to give me a discount. And the guy's like, why? He goes, I think of you guys every time I drive by. He has this fucking way.
Yeah, he does.
Of getting shit. He will take free anything. And like I get embarrassed really easy. You've never seen him not give a fuck about uncomfortableness.
No, and it has nothing to do with saving money.
No,
it has nothing to do. It's the principle of the thing. He just wants to haggle and win.
Yeah. He just wants a show wherever he goes.
Yeah, he's putting on a show.
Well, Jimmy used to do something funny too if we'd be on the road. And we'd, like, walk into a place, and Jimmy'd come in first and open the door and go, excuse us, big store coming through.
I would always walk into a place, really, like, if there was a few people shopping, I'd walk in and go, ladies and gentlemen, prepare to be starstruck. But he loved it. Like, I would be mortified if someone said that. He would just walk in like that's the way it should be when you enter.
Were people starstruck?
What?
Were people starstruck?
Sometimes they were. Other times they were older, and they're like, "Who's the fucking?
What?
Who's the? Yeah, who's the creepy fucking entourage?
Who's the fat Elvis?"
Yeah, exactly. I thought it was Kenny or Happy I was talking about. But yeah, he loved it.
But came back to Celebrity Apprentice. All he had to do was behave a little bit.
Yeah,
he would be the star of that show.
That's what you want—the loose cannon, someone like that. Who cares if the fucking guy dresses in a suit and tries to impress Donald Trump?
They really blew it.
Rather have the guy like Dice just fucking everything up, not making the cupcakes. His fucking cupcakes.
Like, Donald Trump's the only one that takes the reality show seriously. What the fuck? Like, these guys are really going to have a multi-million-dollar contract with Donald Trump.
Yeah.
Changing their careers. It's a silly show. Keep Dice on there, you dummy.
But nobody wants a quitter, Opie.
Yeah, he implied that he was going to quit.
Are you quitting?
Yeah.
No, I'm not being a quitter, but I'm just saying.
It reminds me of in Trading Places when they're in the bathroom at making the dollar bet and they're talking about Eddie Murphy and he's in the bathroom stall and then they say, you know, are you going to keep him on after the bet's over? And he goes, Nick. And he's just like, that's exactly what it's like. It's like,
Randolph.
That's how you're treated if you win The Apprentice. It's like, what are we going to put him on the job? What?
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
Don Ameche with that actorish voice of his, over-enunciating
Those fucking, you and could like nowadays, not get away with a comedy like that.
But not only that, but nowadays an actor like that would be like, I'd rather, could you change that line?
Yes, change it to something less offensive.
He knows that Don Ameche is like, of course, we used to say it all the time. It's, it's almost refreshing.
Don Ameche is saying it off camera. He's just using it.
He doesn't
even
notice.
Go to the trailer and get him.
He reads his script and he's like,
monkey, I would go at it. When I was a kid, forget about it. Anytime, any place. Like a monkey. Multiple times a day. If I was homesick from school, I'd just spend the whole day jacking. I was like a maniac. I was addicted to my hand.
Wasn't that the greatest day ever when you figured out what you could do to yourself?
Oh, just fantastic.
It was the greatest day ever.
Just fantastic.
You know, it all starts with, climbing up those the ropes in gym class. You go, whoa, what's going on down there? I thought this was, just something I used to take a leak.
No, it was like, for me, it was just, looking through porno magazines that you'd find. As a kid, you find them all over the place, in the woods or
in
your dad's closet.
But you have to go back further than that. I mean, the day when you realize, wow.
Mm.
You mean, wow, I could, and wow.
Yeah, but once you put your hand down there, then it's all over. You could get a boner when you're a kid and not know anything, not know what to do with it or anything. But then once you realize that you could do something with it, and then once that first time, actually, it kind of scared me a little bit because I really wasn't sure what the hell was happening. You're just going at it, and you know something feels good, and you keep going because it feels good, and then all of a sudden, kaboom, you're like, what the hell is happening?
You get hit in the eye.
What the hell was that? Like, I thought just the act of doing it without completion was doing it. Because I didn't really have a grasp. Well, I had a good grasp but I didn't.
Did you think you broke it?
Yeah, I thought I broke it. I thought something exploded. It was like, it feels good, and then it starts feeling better and better and better and better. And the faster you go, it's feeling really great. And then all of a sudden, kaboom, and you're like, holy gee, what the hell was that?
You're like, I think I just broke it.
Yeah.
Because you think, it's just supposed to keep continuing.
Yeah. So I got done. Right, and then I went for a little walk in the woods to ponder it,
like a rape victim.
Yeah, like a rape victim. It was.
Was
I'm
this
like
after or before your shower? You had to scrub off the filth.
No, because it was in the shower, so I was able to like take care of that.
All right.
And then I went for a little stroll in the woods. I don't even know how old I was. I could have been 10 or 11 or something. I don't even know. A little stroll in the woods, and then I'm like pondering the whole thing. And then I figured I'd jack it again behind a tree. That was how long it took me to do it again. It was like 10 minutes.
And to your relief, you realize, okay, it's not broken.
All right, this is pretty good. It's not broken. I will do this now multiple times in my life for every day of my life.
And I guarantee that was the day you blew off playing sports and...
That was it.
And picked up the hobby of women.
That was it. Find some porno mags and build a tree fort. and just, I mean, the tree fort, the trees that I built the tree fort in just looked like white sap was running from it for many years.
You hand over the soccer ball back to Dad. Hey, Dad, I'm not going to be using this anymore.
Not going to be needing this. I'm not going to be needing my school books. I'm not going to be needing anything.
Dad, you could sleep in on Sundays from now on. I'm just not into this soccer thing anymore.
I found something I'm much more interested in, and that's what it was.
Right.
It was just I was addicted.
Dad, here's my Little League mitt. Maybe you could give it to, you know, Johnny, yeah, my younger brother, because I won't be using this anymore.
And that just continued for years and years and years and years.
That's funny.
Just jacking.
We got to go right to the phones. Talking about first time you jacked it, I guess.
Yeah, we were kind of talking about that, weren't we?
I don't know how we got. Oh, we got on that subject because of the guy listening to the Sacramento couple yesterday.
Right, right.
Okay, gotcha. Let's say hi to Fred. Hey, Fred, where are you calling from, man?
I'm calling from Augusta, Georgia right now.
Okay. You got a story for us?
Yes, sir. I can remember, I'm 50 years old, so give you that tidbit. I remember the days when we were with my mom, we had her Simpsons Truth catalog, and that's where you're jerking off to. So I remember the first time I got
living. Slow down. What?
Okay. A what catalog?
A Simpsons Sears catalog. I'm from Canada, so that's a Sears catalog.
Sears
right?
catalog. Oh, okay. That you would jack it to.
Yeah, I used to jack it to the pictures of the girls in bras.
In the bras?
Yeah, that was porno back then when you were like, I don't know, 10.
Kind of was. You'd have to look through the circulars and find.
You get that. Or the before and after.
Bikini ads.
The before and after pictures in the back of some of those teen magazines.
Really?
That my older sister had. Where, like, you put this cream
Did
on
you
your.
Jack it to the fat chicks on the.
No. It's even better, actually. I mean, that would be a funny story, too. But they used to have in the back of these magazines a breast cream.
Oh, right.
Remember the breast cream?
Yes.
Where supposedly the teenage girls were supposed to, like, you know, put this cream on their boobs.
And their boobs would get bigger.
And they'd show the before and after picture, and then
That's
you would...
ridiculous.
You would buy this product as a teenage girl, not knowing that it's actually puberty that's making them bigger, not
right.
this stupid cream. All right, so the Sears catalog, you used to jack it to that?
Yeah, but it gives you that type of idea. I remember when I was 12 years old, I was in grade 8. And I wanted to get laid so bad because I was jerking off and I didn't want to know how it felt like. So I finally found this girl in grade 8 who wanted to do it with me. So she was like a wooden floor. So I was great.
Of course she had a wooden floor. She was nothing was happening down there yet.
That's right. So I thought all I had to do was stick it between her legs and I was having sex with her. So we got on the floor in her bedroom. And then I stuck it between her legs. I remember it was too dry, you know, and I didn't want to just stick it between her legs. I told her to squeeze her legs tighter so I could get it in there, and it wouldn't go in, so I had to go down and spit in it, right?
Oh, my God. Only in Georgia.
Jesus.
No surprise here. Wait, were you having sex with her, or were you having sex with her legs?
No, I was having sex with her.
Oh, okay.
But the point was, I didn't know what I was doing. I thought I just had to stick it between her legs, but not in her hole, you see?
Yeah, it's...
So all I did was I spit in the hole, and it got nice and greasy then. Then I got in there and I fucked her.
All right, Jesus.
Then our parents came home.
And then I found out years later that it wasn't sex at all. I had to screw it between your legs. I didn't put it in the hole at all.
All right. Thank you, Fred. You scare me.
That is a frightening
All right, there
man.
Goes Fred.
You are frightening.
We could salvage that call, though. There are things when you're a kid... You know, that you think is sex.
Misconceptions about right. sex that you
so
do
So to
have.
That guy, I think he wasn't sure you were supposed to, as he said, put it in the... You know, I'm not even going to say it. I mean, come on. Let's keep it a little clean on this show.
It sounded so nice and innocent the way he told the story, didn't it?
But
I fuck her!
Right. I think what he was trying to say, back then he thought having sex was just when you... Oh, no. He did know, but... He ended up having sex with her legs.
Opie, I have no idea what that guy was talking about.
I'm really trying to
Somehow
save that phone call.
He had sex with the girl's legs and didn't actually do it, but he thought he was doing it. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if he knew what actually doing it was. He wasn't very clear. He was laughing too hard at his memories.
Right. Well, I talked about this in the past. I thought, I thought you had to do it in the back door and that the other one, the front one was just used for what, you know...
And when did you figure it out the real way? Last week?
Pretty much, yeah.
Like, all the girlfriends are like, ow!
No, it was after the film, obviously. Like, oh that's used for two things.
Well, you're not too clear on the female parts because you don't have them.
Right.
So you're not sure.
Right.
You have the back, right. So you kind of know what that's about. So you assume...
You know what? I think we're going to just do a sex show today, I decided.
Is it completely a sex show?
Because you guys try to tell us what you want to hear on this program. Now we're going to just do sex all day
sexual
long.
Sexual discussion, and then we have sex on the couch.
Didn't you have something similar? What you thought was sex when you were a lot younger?
Yeah, I thought it was backdoor when I was a kid. I guess I was about maybe 7, and I thought it was backdoor. And then when I learned that it was front door.
All right, so you thought it was back door as well.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, I'm not alone.
You're not sure of the anatomy. So you don't even know that there's anything different up there in a girl.
Well, when you're really young and you see the front one.
Yeah.
It's intimidating and quite scary.
Very intimidating indeed.
And when you and I were growing up, you know, women weren't really taking care of that area.
No, no. It was
You couldn't even imagine that was the way to go.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
You just couldn't imagine.
Oh, no. It was very frightening.
It was very frightening.
I was brought into it. Mom, turn the radio off, okay? Don't listen. Because it's, you
know, because we need Anthony to not have to worry about his mom listening.
It's embarrassing talking about, you know, stories.
My mom, it's hilarious. I was listening today. I had to turn you guys off. I'm like,
oh, that's what mine says, too.
That's fine.
She called last night. She's like, yeah, I listen, you know, but there are times I just have to turn it off. It's like, oh, boy, you know, whatever, 65-year-old woman is really the demo we're looking for. So, no, turn it off. That's what, you know, of course you're not going to like some of the stuff we're doing. Especially when you consider it's me telling the stories.
What didn't she like yesterday? The poker chips?
No, she actually didn't listen yesterday. But there have been things. Oh, okay. Whenever we talk about things like this, she doesn't like to listen, which is good. You know, don't listen. When I was a kid and kind of got hooked up through my father in California, my father kind of hooked me up with this girl.
He hooked you up with a lot of girls.
On my, I guess it was my 13th birthday or something like that.
Yeah. Is this the Buzz story?
Yeah, Buzz. Old Buzz. She was a friend of the family. She was like 19 years old. I guess she had banged everybody that we even knew.
Everybody in the town?
Yeah. She was like the town whore.
Was she really?
The town
whore. You never said that before?
Yeah, she banged everybody.
Was she just a local chick in the
bar?
She
banging all my father's horse friends, you know, that would go riding with him and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, your dad was a cowboy after he left Long Island.
He was a cowboy.
Said,
moved out to
Long
Southern
Island,
California.
I'm going to California and I'm going to be a cowboy.
Bought
baby.
A bunch of horses. I went out there, lived out there with him, but he bought me a horse. I had the horse, the whole deal, Opie. I was a Western guy. I wore cowboy boots and the cowboy hat. I was a cowboy. It was pretty funny. Had a six gun. Sure.
A real one?
Real one. Bought it for me for also, I guess, my 12th birthday. Got me that. Got me a rifle.
How long did you live out there? I thought you were just visiting.
14, 15, four, maybe 3 or 4 years.
Oh, you did 3 or 4 years out there.
Yeah, 3 or 4 years.
I thought you just used to visit.
My formative years.
Because I know your mom threw you and your brother on the bus one day.
No, that was actually coming home. I moved out there because I wanted to move out there. I wanted to hang out with my father and ride horses. It's a kid's dream to be a cowboy. My brother got thrown out there by my mother because she didn't want to deal with his pot smoking. My brother's pot smoking, stealing and lying, stealing my mommy's quarters out of the quarter jar to buy joints and lying about it. So mommy threw him out.
So he went first?
No, I went first.
Oh, okay, and then he joined you.
And then he joined me out
there.
Gotcha. Yeah, he wasn't really into the whole cowboy thing, so he just smoked pot out there. It was pretty much doing the same thing, only out there. And
but you got into the cowboy lifestyle.
Oh, I was totally into it. I used to listen to the like stuff you'd hear on Hank's Place.
I love Hank's Place.
I would listen to that. That was my music.
If you guys haven't checked out Hank's Place yet on XM Satellite Radio, I forgot what channel it is, but it's definitely worth checking out. It's like either 10, 11, 12, or 13.
Oh, it's hysterical.
It's way up there, but yeah. Hank's Place rocks. Yeah. It's scary that people think like this in the country.
Oh, it's amazing.
In the country, but
it's Red State Station.
Exactly. Anyway,
and
go ahead.
I was one of them. I love that music. So, yeah, I was a cowboy. And she was like the town whore, Buzz. And one night, my father and his girlfriend at the time were going out. And just kind of left Buzz there and kind of were smiling, like winking or something when they left. I didn't know what was happening.
And you were 13? 12?
Yeah, I guess I was 13. Yeah. And then... And
was
then,
this for your birthday?
Yeah. It was my birthday present. And then Buzz goes, why don't you go upstairs and take a shower? I'm like, oh, okay. Not thinking anything about it.
Well, you know? I was riding my horse today.
I had
I'm a
cowboy dirt on me.
Okay.
I had cowboy dirt on me. So I did, and I get out of the shower, and I'm ready to walk back downstairs and watch TV with Buzz. And I hear from the bedroom, aren't you coming in? I'm like, and no, it didn't even hit me at that point.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking, now what's the voice coming from in the bedroom? She was downstairs. Now, why would she be, oh.
It finally hits you.
Oh.
You're like, this is it.
Oh,
this is it.
Here it comes. I'm going to put all that jack into good use. Yeah, so I heard.
Did you get an immediate boner?
Oh, yeah. What are you kidding? You get that whoosh feeling all over?
Well, that's the blood just rushing. Oh,
here it comes. Here comes that sex stuff. And then I kind of peer around the corner, and I look in the bed, and this vision is just etched in my head. It's Buzz.
Is it still a really hot vision for you?
It's one of those nice little memories you have as a kid. I remember seeing Buzz sitting in my bed.
Yeah.
But she's sitting up with her head and torso against the headboard.
Was she hot? Be honest.
No, she was.
I've heard the story a couple times.
You know what it was? She wasn't fat at all, but she was a big girl, like tall and not skinny, but not fat. And she had huge cans.
How much bigger was she than you?
It must have looked ridiculous.
Oh, okay.
Let's just put
I've
it
never
that
heard
way.
This part of the story, because you're 12, 13.
I was 13.
13.
Yeah.
You couldn't have weighed more than, what, 110, 120 pounds?
I don't know. I was a little more than that. But, you know, it just must have looked ridiculous.
All right.
And she was sitting up in the bed with the blanket, like, in her lap. It just came up to her lap. So her huge cans were sitting there. All milky white.
They were huge.
Oh, they were huge. They were huge.
With nice blue veins.
No. They were just
when
huge.
You see the blood just pumping.
Boom, boom, translucent.
Pumping to the nipple.
Boom, 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 boom.
She milky was sitting white. There,
and I looked in, and it was pretty much the first time I ever saw him real live. You know, I've seen a lot of porno.
Yeah.
I had seen a lot of porno at that point.
And they sat up nice?
Yeah, because she was 19, you know?
Oh, okay.
She was 19. She was the older woman to me.
I know. When you tell the story, I keep thinking, like, she was a 30-year-old woman.
No,
but
she was
19 and you were 13.
19.
All right.
Yeah. And, yeah, she goes, well, why don't you come in? I'm like, all right. You know, I went in, and the rest is my history. You know, it happened.
Oh, you want to stop the story right there?
Well, I knew what to do, so there's no real details.
How long did you last?
It wasn't that long.
How long?
You know?
Be honest.
I don't know.
A couple pumps?
I honestly would tell you, I really don't remember, but dude, no, I remember kind of getting into it.
The first time you do it, come on.
You know what, though?
You were drunk?
I had jacked it in the shower that I had just taken. I had jacked it in the shower.
You were a jacking machine,
man. Monkey! I was like a monkey. I swear to you, a monkey.
So did you just do regular sex?
Yeah, but the point is, and how this got brought up with the intimidation factor of the vag when you first see
it's quite scary the first time you see it.
And dude, this was
and there's a lot of parts down there. And you're like, wow, what does all that do?
Oh my god, I'm gonna need a chart.
Right, give me a map.
You know, we had continued to have sex for months afterwards. You know, like I was going to she would show up at the house after my father and his girlfriend would leave in the mornings before school. So I'm getting ready to go to school, and she would pop into my bed. And we'd have sex, and off I'd go to school.
Now, what's messed up? If it was a 19-year-old guy and a 13-year-old girl...
Yeah, I did get in trouble for that.
What?
Kidding.
Oh, okay. You know, people wouldn't think that's cool. Like, a guy hearing that, you know, hearing you tell the story that you're 13 banging a 19-year-old, that is a really cool story.
Uh-huh.
Every guy dreamt that could happen to them when they were growing up.
I told people at school, and they didn't believe me. They thought I was just another one of their friends lying to them. They're like, get out of here. I'm like, no, really? I just had sex.
Were you the first one?
Smell my finger.
Were you the first one to have sex?
Yeah, yeah.
And your group of friends?
Oh, yeah.
Must
yeah.
have. That's like really young.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
But the one of these sexual encounters before school, you know, she goes down on me. And it was just, you know, wee-hoo, boy. This is goody-goody. More fun than toys. And then she goes, would you like to do this to me?
Oh, no.
And dude, I am talking. She wasn't that old.
Crank this up, baby.
Oh, she wasn't that old. 19. Still had teen in the name. Still a teen. Not a nasty Mrs. Robinson. Yeah, like I'm banging Dean Wormer's wife. With those pointy tits in her bra.
This music's playing in your head.
No!
As he pulls down her huge panties.
Yeah, he pulled down her huge... She did have big 70s panties. Like, you know the ones that just are not cut at all up the legs?
Yeah.
Just big bloomers? Those were the ones.
Let me step out of my bloomers.
Yeah.
And it had to be a mess because this was like the 70s, right?
She kicked the, yeah.
Late 70s, maybe?
Kicks the bloomers over the lamp and the whole room goes dark. Her big bloomers.
So she goes, would you like to do this to me?
Would you like to do this to me? And the only vision I had was the vision I saw of it before I, you know, put it in. So I remembered what it looked like very vividly.
What did it look like? Come on.
Dude, it was as if you had punched Fidel Castro in the mouth and his lips
and
swelled
and
up.
Knocked out all his teeth.
Yeah, that's what it looked like. It looked like Albert Einstein with a head wound. It was awful.
And there was
big.
And there was a couple shots of Novocaine in the lips.
Yeah, yeah. Like he was going for droopy dentistry. Right. And the hair was spread out so far, like past the area. She had like leg hair on that. It was giant.
Thank God you just don't see that these days.
You just don't.
You know?
You don't, thank God.
Because it used to grow, I don't know, man. Maybe we were brought up as cavemen in some other era because it used to grow like halfway down their thighs.
Down the thigh?
Man.
It doesn't even grow like that anymore?
I don't know.
Girls
don't
are
so.
Less hairy, more gooder now.
But know what the problem is? All these styles come back. That style will come back.
You think?
Before our time is done on this earth.
I don't think so.
We are going to have to deal with that again. I'm telling you.
I don't think so.
I'm telling you.
That's like the Hitler mustache. Not down there, but the Hitler mustache on your face. I never see that coming back again.
I'm telling you, man. It's going to come back.
Yeah.
All right, so.
She sat on the edge of the bed one time, naked. And when she was sitting and her lap, you know, her leg, she was bent at the waist because she's sitting. It looked like she was wearing black furry panties.
Ugh.
Her pubes were just so stretched out.
I can't imagine girls were getting a lot of oral back then.
Yeah,
I can't
I know.
Imagine. Because now today, you know, most of the girls are completely shaved.
But just think of the hairy mess when they did. Big Burt Reynolds mustache and pork chop sideburns going down on a chick with a rug in her lap. Just a big hairy mess all around. God. Oh, cavemen. Yeah, that went on for years.
So did you do it?
Until I left back to... No. I went...
How'd you get out of it?
She goes, would you mind doing this to me? And I just went, I don't think so. I did. I said, I don't think so. She knew I was a rookie.
So then what
I'm
happened?
I'm not ready to go for the big league.
So what happened then?
We just continued having regular sex.
Yeah.
You know, she didn't cut me off from it.
That's great, man.
I guess she understood.
You're going to eighth grade getting banged every morning. That's
it was
amazing.
Odd. You know, it was pretty
That's
odd.
That's amazing, man.
And then girls my own age, I was like, you know, geez, this chick don't know shit.
And she doesn't
Can you help a brother out?
She doesn't even have boobs yet.
I'm like, hey, would you, you know, mind doing this to me? And they go, I don't think so.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Wow, that's funny, man.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Hank's Place is Channel 13. Good.
Channel 13.
All right. Let me see if Ozzy could... that's a great story, by the way, Anthony.
Oh,
more
it was,
details.
It was greater to live, Opie.
More details.
And then the next day,
yeah.
I got in the truck with my dad. He was driving me to school. And he kind of just looks over and goes, so, how was last night?
That's a cool dad, man. For my 13th birthday, I got a 10-speed bike.
Wouldn't it be fun to know what you,
you
know
now?
You
got a hooker. You basically got a hooker. Yeah,
well, she was, it wasn't money.
Did
thing.
Your dad bang her too?
Probably. Who knows? Probably compare notes. Yeah, dad. I snatch. What it was, yeah, now it kind of threw me. Yes. How was last night? Oh, if you knew what you know now, like what you, I could have come back with, it's like, so how was last night? And go, oh, dad, I don't like girls, you know. You know, thanks for the effort and stuff, but I really don't like girls.
Yeah. Man, that's.
Freak them out.
Yeah, that's
yeah, it was like, wow, no, it was, you know, it was cool. It was good.
You had the coolest dad in school.
That's right.
Your brother wants in on the conversation.
Oh, yeah?
About you and Buzz when you were a kid, Anthony.
Oh, let's
out there
see.
In California.
Let's see what Joe's going to add.
Brother Joe, Anthony's brother, of course. Joey! Joe!
Yo!
Hey, hey what's up, man? You're on the air.
Yeah.
What the hell happened?
What's up?
What the hell's wrong with you?
Nothing, man. I was just getting gas. I'm on my way back from Atlantic City.
Oh, you're getting gas? Okay.
Yeah, I'm coming back from Atlantic City. I just saw Tom Jones.
Oh, how was that?
It was cool, man.
Did he do dry vagina?
Bunch of goddamn old, a bunch of old ladies, though. It was hysterical, man. They're like throwing these big old bloomers up at him.
Do they still throw their underwear at that guy?
Oh, it's hysterical, man.
Oh,
I love, Joe, you have a great life now, man. You don't have to get up early to do
Oh, Joe just cruises around the world.
He's just doing his band thing and
going to
see,
Tom Jones concerts.
See Tom Jones because he can now.
How does Tom Jones sound, Joe?
Things are good. You guys have made it that way for me. Thank you very much.
What's Tom Jones sound like? Any good?
Dry. Was that a Tom Jones song originally?
Yeah.
The guy sounded incredible. He was really good, man.
Still has his pipes.
Great show. That hasn't lost a thing.
Wow, very cool.
Hasn't lost a thing.
I got to go check him out. Pretty that's, fun.
Well, anyway, I'm calling to talk about Buzz for a second.
Yes.
Oh, Anthony tends to whitewash things just a little bit.
What did I whitewash?
Oh, my God. She didn't sound like a beauty.
Nothing about... No. Everything's good as far as your detail goes, except for one thing. Buzz looked like a Cro-Magnon. She had...
All right.
She had the distended brow.
She had the unibrow.
Oh, my God. Well, that's a detail that you forgot to tell us, Anthony.
I wasn't looking at her face. I was horrified at the vag.
What was hairier, her vag or her head?
It looked the same.
Or
the
her
eyebrow.
Face, I should say.
She
Jesus.
Had a univag and a unibrow.
Wow.
You were talking about the hair thing. I mean, that was directly due to the fact that she was like a Neanderthal.
Hey, at least I wasn't 15 banging that 30-year-old mother with a friggin' axe crotch.
Wait a second, dude. She was 32.
Are we going to get a new story today?
Oh, there was one time I was with Buzz in one of these bedrooms in this house.
Joe's the older brother. Go ahead.
And Joe was slamming this 32-year-old mom.
While you were banging Buzz?
Yeah, in the same room. And Joe goes, hey, at midnight, let's switch. And I said, there is no way I'm banging that old broad.
All right, hold
and
on.
And she walked like she'd been riding a horse for about 18 years. That girl, what was her name? Do you remember?
Sue.
This girl, Sue, woman, Sue, her legs were so spread apart and she had the gap, like where her vag was supposed to be, was a gap like a hatchet wound.
Was that from riding horses?
I don't know what it was from.
Or maybe doing horses.
Maybe getting slammed by everything that walked.
But, dude, she had to accommodate me, so it worked.
All right, wait a minute.
Oh, sure.
Hold on. Let's slow down, guys. Slow down. So, I got to get the visual here.
Yeah.
You're 13, Anthony. You're banging Buzz.
Yeah.
While Dad's out doing his thing.
Uh-huh.
And Joe's in the bed.
I was probably 14 at this time.
All right. And Joe's in the bed next to you, banging a 32-year-old?
No, a different room.
Oh, okay.
No, he was in a different room. It was there was a hallway and then two rooms at the end of each hallway.
Did you hear each other going at it?
I don't think so. There was Peter Frampton was playing.
Oh my God.
They always used to put the Frampton Comes Alive album on.
Come on.
I swear. Sue would always put the Frampton Comes Alive album on blasting. And all we heard was, wah, 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 wah. Don't you feel like we do?
That was wasn't Frampton. That was actually you going down on Buzz.
The old man hooked me up with her as well. I mean, the old
really?
Man did a lot for us that way.
Oh, there it is. There's some Frampton.
Is this bringing back memories,
Oh, it's
boys?
Bringing back such memories.
Jesus.
Yeah, I think the old man was banging Sue also.
Probably.
Yeah.
All right, wait, so Joe was a little older, so you were only 15 or 16 banging the 32-year-old?
Yeah, I was about 16, I guess.
So. Yeah, and he was banging the 32-year-old and wanted to switch at midnight.
What, you guys had a little conference in the hallway?
Yeah, yeah.
In between banging?
We saw Sue breaking out the Frampton album. We knew we were getting laid. So,
real tag team.
Yeah, so Joe wanted to do the switch, and man, I had, believe it or not, Buzz with the unibrow, the big 70s Earth Mama muff, the big Amazon woman was bad enough. But this is telling how bad Sue was. I wanted no part of her. There was nothing about Sue that was turning me on. She was much too old.
She was thin, though. She was thin. She was small.
She was emaciated. She had flapjack tits. She had two. She had two kids who were in the other room. She had two kids in the other room.
Wait.
In the other room?
Yeah, there was another room that the kids were in.
This was a flop house.
Oh, it was a ridiculous.
I swear to God, man, I would have gone through five Sues before I would have taken one Buzz.
You wanted Buzz. You were the one that recommended the switch, that suggested the switch at midnight.
Dude, that was because I was 15 and I figured, what the fuck? We were screwing around. It would be fun, something to do. Switch it up a little bit.
Horrifying.
What were the kids doing while you were banging their mother?
They're probably playing with Legos. Who the hell knows? Who the hell knows?
But did they call you Daddy Joe?
The girl walking in one time on me.
Oh, great.
The little girl walks
in on us one time.
She was like 7.
I know, and she was only about maybe 6 years younger than me, right?
Can we find any of these people?
Who knows? I don't know. That guy, what the hell's going on in California? Sue's probably...
Which hippie colleague should we check? You guys are a bunch of hippies out there.
Yeah, hippies.
With Tom Jones last night. Who knows?
Probably.
She's old.
Old
She's
broad.
Old
Joe, you had a great father, man.
I'm telling you.
He liked to party, that's for sure.
He gave you guys poo-ha, man.
I remember. Alcohol, yeah. And guns, alcohol, and the bitches. He hooked us up.
You know what my
horses,
dad gave me?
Booze, bitches.
My dad gave me a good jump shot.
There you go.
That's what I got from my dad, a good jump shot.
I used to come
and really good ball handling skills, and you guys are getting poo-ha, man.
I used to come home from school. I went to a Marco Forster Junior High School, and it was right by the stable where we kept the horses. So I would get done with school about 3 o'clock, walk back to the stable. And every day, my father, who for some reason couldn't hold a job, was sitting in a chair with Chato, the Mexican guy that had a horse at the same ranch. And they would just sit there drinking what they called yambos. They were the big 40-ounce beers. Why don't we get another Yambo, Yoey? And then they'd sit there just drinking beer. And when their wives or girlfriends would bitch at them, they would look at each other and go, I'm going to get me another one. And this was their life. Riding horses, drinking,
and banging.
Screwing girls like Buzz and Sue.
Yeah.
So he was getting us right in line to do that. Drinking beer, riding horses, and screwing women.
Making homebrew.
And making the homebrew. They used to get these casks from these whiskey factories. Big wooden barrels. And they would take them back to the ranch, fill them up with like 5 gallons of water, and then roll it. Every couple of days, you'd roll it like a quarter roll. And then after a month, you'd drain it out, and you'd get 1 gallon of liquid that would come out. But it was pure alcohol that it
would
leach out of the wood from the casks. And we're kids! And they're giving us shots of this stuff. We were fucked up. I mean, completely hammered.
I've never seen that.
What a great way to be raised.
Dude, you drank a glass. You had it on the rocks.
Yep.
And stood up from
That's how I drank at 13. On the rocks.
On the rocks. Go ahead, Joe. Joey.
Yo.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, and then you proceeded to go straight down to your knees.
Oh, yeah. Took a big shot and just went thud. Passed out. It was great.
Why straight down to your knees? Buzz was standing in front of Anthony.
No, I wouldn't have gotten on my knees for Buzz, that's for sure. Looked like tumbleweed rolled in her lap.
All right, you know what? To wrap this up, you guys got to tell the story of Mom finally calling out to California and going, boys, it's time to come home. I think she was a little concerned for your safety.
Oh, that was when we had decided it was time to come back east. And maybe get civilized for a little while. I was just coming back to visit. Joe, of course, was coming back to live there. But after I visited with my family here in New York for a while, I realized I was kind of programmed in California. And they kind of deprogrammed me here in New York. And I decided I better stay because I really was heading on the road to ruin out there.
But it's funny how you guys got back home. You had to take the bus trip,
right? Yeah, well, my mother had sent out 2 airline tickets. for me and my brother to fly us from California to New York. So my father got the tickets, went to the airline, sold the tickets, took the money, and bought us two Greyhound bus tickets and put us on the bus. And there we were on this two-week-long
excursion.
You
can't be pissed at him because he gave you poo-ha, man.
There you
go. Riding along with hookers and pimps.
Yeah, so we were taking a bus all the way from California, L.A., to New York City. And it stopped at every city. You know, we stopped everywhere. And the collection of dregs of society, male hookers, hustlers, girl hookers, pimps, and I'm talking like Huggy Bear pimps, these guys with the fur hats and everything. It was just a collection. An Ouzo bum who had a bottle of Ouzo with him the whole trip that everybody, when he passed out, would take and pass around the bottle. And we were drinking this bum's Ouzo, this hot chick we met that was getting off in Cheyenne, but decided to hang out with us all the way into New York. Who knows what happened to her? Probably murdered or ended up a hooker. And then we finally get to New York after 2 weeks on the road. And right when we step off the bus, we get arrested by NYPD. This detective comes over.
Came up to me and grabbed me by the shoulder and said, "Excuse me, boys, you have to come with me," right?
Mm-hmm.
And now you left out the fact that I was smuggling in Thai sticks.
Right. Now the cop goes, "Come with me, get your bags." And we're like, "Oh, my God. Joe's got, like, pounds of Thai sticks."
How old were you, Joe?
Oh, God.
Probably 17 now. I think you were 17.
Oh, okay.
I was about 17, 16, 17.
And he just, like, a load of Thai stick in his bag. And the guy goes, "We're going to get your bags. And we're going to check you out," you know, because they thought we were runaways. They thought we were runaways coming into New York to, you know, hustle or something. So thank God that girl did follow us from Cheyenne and just hang out with us on the bus. We told her, "Could you get this one bag and get it immediately before we get there?" And she ran and got the bag and actually didn't steal it and took it. And then the cop goes to call my mom up, and I'm like, "Could you just identify yourself and first say your kids are fine? I'm NYPD. And I just took them, and I want to verify that they're not runaways." He gets on the phone. "Hello, Rosemary. Yes. Do you have two sons, Joseph and Anthony?" Yeah, and my mother's horrified. This guy just strung it along without, like, telling her we were okay. Guy was a real prick. But we got off the hook.
God, remember the knives that the old man gave us?
Yeah, he, like, confiscated our knives.
My side, the cop was patting me down. You know, he goes, "Oh, what's this? What's this?" Puts his hand over by his gun, takes the knife away.
Yeah, what a collar.
Yeah.
What a collar, getting the Kumia boys.
Goddamn hysterical. Yeah.
Well, thank you for the memories, Joe. I forgot about Sue.
All right.
Well, more stories than that, though, for another day. The Mojave Desert.
Shootings and everything.
Yeah, we'll talk about the shooting next time you call in.
I saw more shootings than Puffy.
Yeah.
On an entire show, too.
Yeah. Oh, that's a great story, but you're going to have to tell it live in the studio, though.
But, Joe, bashing Buzz when you're banging a Sue.
Guns lately. You got to talk about guns.
Michael Moore is just proving he's very accurate.
What?
I read what he said, and I'm like, well, describes me.
Oh, really? Okay.
Like, what am I going to do?
Well, let's play this clip, then. They can't get enough of the gun discussion on TV these days.
They love talking guns.
I'm more worried about cabs and fucking those black town cars.
I love the guns.
Than guns.
My God, man.
Yes, and I am loath to bring up what is in our head because we don't like to talk about it so much. But on this particular day, on Martin Luther King Day, I think this needs to be said. That imaginary person that's going to break into your home and kill you, who does that person look like? You know, it's not freckled-faced Jimmy down the street, is it, really? I mean, that's not what really people... We never really want to talk about the racial or the class part of this in terms of how it's the poor or it's people of color that we imagine we're afraid of. Why are we afraid? What is that? And it's been a fear that has existed for a very, very long time. And, you know, but I love this quote by Martin Luther King. Somebody said to him one time, you know, why do we need to enact a federal anti-lynching law? You know, I mean, you can't force people to love each other. You can't, you know, a law isn't going to make somebody not a racist. And he said, Yeah, that's true. You can't legalize us getting along with each other. But I have a feeling if we pass an anti-lynching law, it probably is going to help. And it did. And we need these laws. But we also need to address the larger issue of why are we such a violent people? And not just personal domestic violence, but a nation that invades other countries, that has such a huge weapons budget, that just seems just so intent on violence being the answer. And I think that's the thing we want to dance around here. We're afraid of really talking about it. If we can just focus on something else, we're going to be okay.
He is such an asshole, by the way.
But we met him.
Yeah, we met him, all right.
He was nice to us. He liked us.
Because he's a phony crock of shit, is what I saw.
I can't
he's
hate any
phony.
I can't hate anyone I've met.
I hate him. He's a phony. He's a phony. He's got an image and a persona that he puts across as this, you know, liberal, look at me, I'm out for this little guy thing. And then you sit and talk with him for 10 minutes and you realize he's a fucking, you know, he's just a showbiz guy looking to sell his next project.
Aren't they all show busy on TV, though?
Oh, yeah, yeah. But he tries to come across
like he's not show
really,
busy?
Really into his causes and stuff.
It's hard to take Bill O'Reilly serious. When he's yelling and screaming and then does a plug for his fucking no spin zone coffee mug.
Coffee mugs
and frisbees and whatever the else he slaps a label on.
Everyone's hawking
Keith Olbermann
their wares.
Does the same shit.
Let me address something here.
Sure, sure.
Statistically, Michael Moore described what home invaders look like and where they come from. This imaginary person that breaks into your house, if they're there to rob your house or unless it's a personal attack on you for something work related or marriage dispute or cheating or something like that. If a criminal is breaking into your house in a home invasion, statistically, it's probably going to be a young black male. That's just police investigating attempted break-in in Kings Point, Long Island. Long Island home invasion. It's right up on the Fox 5 screen I'm looking at right now.
Why is Long Island?
Now get me a description, please.
Why is Long Island the capital of home invasions?
Because I'll tell you.
I mean, for the people, I hope they understand. We're in Manhattan right now. Okay. To our east is Long Island. To our west is Jersey, and then you go north. You got Connecticut and all that. But when it comes to home invasions, they never talk about home invasions in Jersey or anywhere else. It's always Long Island.
Long Island's an easy place to do a home invasion because you're close to major thoroughfares, major arteries that take you right back to the city again. So you could rob a place, get back on the highway, and then you're back on the road. You're out of that town that you just robbed a house in. And you're back into the city, wherever the fuck you come from, probably the city.
Mm-hmm.
But the thought that Michael Moore sits there and says that statistics say that the gun crime, things like this, gang-related violence, it's going to be minorities. It's going to be minorities. And when he talks about why we're such a violent country and going to war against other nations, that's his idea of a violent country, is the white politician being violent or this asshole in Arizona being the violent guy with the gun. Hey, Michael Moore, how about the fucking thousands of gang-related minority shootings that happen with illegal guns every year in this country?
Mm-hmm.
Address those. What, those people get a free pass, Michael Moore? Because they're black or Hispanic? Because white people are afraid of home invasions? Of which, as I'm talking about you and this imaginary home invasion shit, I look up on the TV at the same time. Swear to God. We were just talking about it. I look up, and right by my home, I'm looking at a home invasion. So don't tell me what's imaginary. By the way, you fat fuck. I bet you I could talk to him live down there at the Whopper place. I might as well just go down there. Odds are he's down there.
Getting his breakfast.
He's a guy that does not want to look at reality. He's got this fucking fantasy world in his head that all this crime,
All this minority crime, black on black crime, black on white, Hispanic against black, black against Hispanic. Look at the L.A. gangs just wiping each other out. He thinks that somehow white people are all responsible for this violence. It's Whitey. It ain't Whitey. Tell them to behave. Make a movie called Fucking Behave.
Jesus.
How about you do that?
What the hell?
Bowling for Behave. Do that. I want to see you make that movie. Bowling for Behave. Ah. Oh, fuck him.
Wow. And Michael Moore, to add to the discussion, he's an NRA member, isn't he? Lifetime.
He did that to fucking be able to fuck with the NRA. It's like Easy okay, E going on. To the fucking Republican dinner.
All right, when did he join the NRA? That's,
probably when he was a kid. He said
I'm here
he,
Lifetime. So he said, if he was a kid, he didn't know any better as a kid. But if he joined the NRA only, I don't know, 10 years ago or so, then it's very calculated.
I don't know when he joined the NRA. He's in one of his movies, it might be Bowling for Columbine, he talks about how he had hunted as a kid, and him and his dad would go out and shoot with rifles. And
the hell was he hunting
like
in Flint, Michigan?
Yeah, Flint, Michigan. Yeah, go to Flint now, and of course it's all
I'm
because
hunting
of
the guy that took my car.
Yeah.
That's Flint, Michigan.
And all the crime there is because of the auto industry going down and white people again, just rich white people fucking over. Why there's so much crime.
Yeah.
How about you just behave? How about you don't depend on Whitey to fuck you over or do good for you? How about you look around your neighborhood, realize, holy shit, there's a shitstorm going on every fucking night here with gunfire and everything else. And you fucking take care of your own block. And then the other guys take care of their block. And before you know it, you got a little neighborhood starting. It's like a game, like Sim City. There you go. It's like Sim City. Fix your shit.
I thought you wanted to stay in a good mood.
Bowling for Behave.
That's going to be the line of the day. By the
I'm
way, Danny.
Tired of him.
We got to do line of the day again. It's time. Yeah. With bowling. What is it?
Bowling for Behave.
Bowling for Behave.
Just behave yourselves.
We got to bring back Line of the Day officially.
Michael Moore's an asshole. And I'll tell you one thing.
We had him on the show. You didn't say any of this stuff to
him.
Oh,
if he was here right now today and he came up with that lame-ass fuck statement that everybody that owns a gun is racist and fears people of color. That's what it is. You fear people of color and you're racist. How is it racist and fearing people of color when every time I see a home invasion, convenience store security cameras, people being shot, a large majority of the time, it's minorities doing it. I'm just stating fact here. I've looked at FBI statistics. I've looked at them. I've seen them. And he just wants to, he's constantly blaming Whitey. See, he had to say, oh, it's not the freckle-faced guy. Hey, Amy, oh, what, the white guy?
Mm-hmm.
Look at the alarm commercials. He must love those. Oh, look, it's an accurate depiction of a white guy kicking in the door in a suburban neighborhood. Stop already. This Michael Moore with his lines of shit. What's the matter? No interest in any of your projects? You got to come up and chime in on this Tucson situation?
Well, why don't we get him on the air? Roland, try to get Michael Moore on the air today.
Yeah, get dumb Michael Moore.
Yeah, he might take a call from
Michael
us today.
Michael Moore.
Yeah.
Stop it already.
No Whoppers till 10:30.
More importantly.
And no more pizza burger.
Why did they get rid of that?
The fuck is going on with our Whoppers?
I don't know. I'm getting the text updates from Trav Dog.
Trav Dog went to tell him to go to Pop Tart World.
Stupid Pop Tart.
Tell him to stop by Pop Tart World and see if that place is still in business.
How's that place doing?
Worst business idea ever, Pop Tart World. Check it out for yourself if you ever make it to Times Square.
Yeah.
It's a disaster of a business model.
They thought it was going to be like the M&M store, and it ain't quite panning out, is it?
Not at all. So
Tart store.
Joseph H. from Charlotte. Did Jay Moore really say this? Per Jay Moore, he writes. Rachel Maddow is Fred Savage all grown up.
That's pretty good. What was Rachel Maddow saying? Anything?
Did she chime in? Not really.
Everyone that owns a gun, as Michael Moore says, is racist
and has a fear of people of color. Media.
Let me go to Justin in Tampa. He wants to argue with you a little bit.
All right, Justin.
We're not going to make a thing out of this. We're going to move on to the material. But Justin, you got through in the nick of time. Go.
All right. How much of this? And I know you say you read the FBI statistics, but how much of this is the media covering, you know, the black guy that's the home invader? And then on the opposite end of the spectrum, you know, there's a story about this. This 19-year-old black girl who comes home from college, goes to visit some friends in Baltimore, and disappears. And, you know, the mayor or the police chief of Baltimore says, this is our Natalie Holloway, but it's a black girl. No one's covering it. If it was a little white girl, it would be all over the news. So how much does the media play a role in this?
You're talking about two different things. As far as abductions go, the media will always concentrate a lot more on the little blonde-haired white girl than they will the black girl. Don't know why. That's just the way it is.
I've never seen a program stopped for a special report because a black girl is missing.
Yeah, yeah.
So I guess if you watch TV, you got to assume that black girls are never abducted.
Never abducted,
right?
Just never happens, I guess.
They're not gonna stop your American Idol to tell you that some girl went missing, girl went missing. But if she has blonde hair and blue eyes, boy, man,
yeah,
you're not gonna be watching American Idol for a while.
It's it also has to do with demographics, and the news wants to tug on the old heartstrings of the most people they can, and when you're talking 10-11% of the population being black, I think the news sees that as like, well, how many people are really going to be interested? But if we put a little, you know, blonde JonBenet looking thing on there, we're going to really get a lot of viewers. Now, that's totally different than black crime, because that could be looked at with statistics, with arrest records, with it's something that could actually be looked at. And it's very rare. I would love to watch First 48 and see a fuckload of white people killing other white people on that show and have investigators find out that, you know, it's a couple of white guys and they killed a white guy. It's constantly black on black murders on First 48. Very rarely you'll see white people. You'll see Hispanics. But for the most part, it's amazing how many black people are killing each other out there.
Well, so Anthony, then is it can we agree that it's a lot of how do we scare white people in the media?
No, it's
you know, but
white
it's people by showing little white girls being abducted.
How is it? I'm not talking about white girls being abducted. People. That's not my point. I'm never making that point. I agree with that. What I'm saying is crime. I'm talking gun crime here. Let's talk gun crime. We're talking about a lot of disproportionate number of minorities committing gun crimes.
Well, I'll agree with that. But
all right.
At the same time, it's when white people get angry at each other, we don't shoot each other, we sue each other. It's just a tattoo?
Like
a totally different thing.
So you called up to argue, yet you're agreeing with me?
No. What I'm saying is my argument was how much of it is the media just wanting to show what they want to show and wanting to show things that scare the people watching.
Nah, you're arguing apples and eggplants. I don't want to sit here and argue that.
Whoa.
All right, boys. You'll have a good day.
All right. See, he got scared. He ran away.
He did run away.
So what? Bowling for what?
Bowling for Behave.
Bowling for Behave. I'm trying to think if we could rework some other black movies with the word behave.
I'm sick of him.
I'm smelling a bit today.
I'm sick of Michael Moore.
Are you? Is he really hurting anybody?
Yes.
Who's
he's
he hurting?
Spreading his dumbass shit liberal bullshit propaganda. And that dumbass no ratings channel with Rachel Maddow.
No.
Isn't that funny?
No. They cleaned her up and made her look like...
They cleaned her up.
They made her look like a girl before they gave her a TV show.
A girl?
Have you seen the pictures of her before they decided to put her on TV?
Yeah, but
they softened her up.
Yeah, well,
she's more manly than Travis before she was doing TV.
Looks like a guy.
Find pictures of what she used to look like before they had to make her sort of look feminine for...
I'll sell the fucking thing.
Anthony.
Yeah, Paul.
DePaulo brought it up right before he's leaving. I actually thought he might have forgotten, but
Nick DePaulo.
He seemed very hesitant to even go there and bring it up.
He was on the Boomer show there,
and he
mentioned that because I told Nick DePaulo the story when he was just here about how I got in a fight with Boomer, and I guess he brought it up. We used to live in the same neighborhood as an elementary school. What did he say?
He said, to start off, he said that one of the first things he brought up was that he remembers your house, and he referred to it as the Munster's house. He said the lawn was never mowed. There were vultures that hung out on the roof of your house.
Vultures! Let me tell you something, sir, and Boomer. My mother was trying to raise the kids when dad wasn't really around to push the old lawnmower. All right? Yeah. He was pushing his dick into some fucking young chippy in Connecticut.
What's that? And the lawn was mowed, so was the sun.
Jesus Christ. Wow. Son of a bitch.
I think we got the clip, actually.
Yeah?
Yeah, thank you, Paul.
E-Rock.
He calls you Eddie Munster. He said the way your house looked and the way you would walk out of your house.
Oh, man. Eddie Munster with an afro. Maybe.
Slowly going crazy beard. That's what Eric has.
All right, let's listen to this.
We all didn't have dad to fucking throw the old football around with us every day, Boomer. Like you.
Dick. Mr. Fucking from O&A, right?
Oh. Mr. fucking gym teacher sweetheart. How'd that work out for? Oh, dude.
Here's Nick DePaulo on Boomer and Carton.
Yeah.
Yes. I just came from O&A, right? And Anthony Comey said, tell
him. Yeah, right. You know the story.
He tried
to hit me. He actually hit me and he broke his arm.
That's what he said. His wrist and forearm disintegrated.
Tell him the story. Go ahead.
We
got into a little altercation.
Were you friends at that point?
Yeah, he lived right down the street from me. Now, when you go past his house on Country Village Lane, and anybody who's living out in East Islip knows this, he had a one level house. It was just like a ranch house, but it was like the Munsters. I mean, nobody cut the grass. There were like vultures flying over it. All the window shades were pulled down, and he had his brother in there. I think he had a hot mom, if I remember correctly. And
that would be Marilyn.
Right. And somehow he and I got into an altercation over something. I forget what it was
about. Come on, what was it? That's what I want to know.
I really forget what it was about, but I remember he figured, okay, he's small, and he's going to take the first shot, so let's see what happens. And he kind of caught me off guard because he hit me right on the side of the head.
And he broke.
He was like, oh! I'm like, are you okay?
How embarrassing.
He had to say, are you okay?
I kicked my own ass on Boomer's head.
Oh, that's great.
Right in the on the side of the head.
And he broke.
He was like, oh! I'm like, are you okay?
Guy gets punched in the head and looks at the guy, are you okay?
And the thing about it is, I didn't know whether to hit him back or not. I feel sorry for him.
And you were huge. You're like the size you were now.
No, it wasn't this heavy. No? I mean, I was tall and skinny, but he hit me in the side of my Norwegian
Did you
square
punch head. Him afterwards or no?
I can't remember. I really can't. I really can't. All it's I remember great. Is that he was like a little, like, you know, he came out of that house like Eddie Munster. And, you know, and it was like just a weird deal.
Is Boomer's gone on with them and they've talked. Lived it out.
Yeah, I don't
know.
Oh,
really? They've been telling the story for like, what, 30 years now?
I've been a fan of theirs for a long time. And I always knew the story. And then the one time I'm listening when I'm the Jet quarterback and he starts talking about it, I'm like, damn.
That's the guy.
I got in a fight with Joe Kapp in junior high school.
There you go.
He's 70, isn't he, Joe?
Did you take him or no?
Oh, I smacked him silly.
Yeah, were you looking over Joe Kapp? Do I punch him or do I help him back up?
You saw that video of him, right?
What I remember about that, though, was a very, very weird kind of whole thing after he hit me.
Weird what way?
Because I didn't know whether to, because I knew he was hurt, because I think he started crying, but I didn't know whether to speed him up or to help him go to the hospital.
That's very nice of you.
Yeah, well.
How we know you were a quarterback. Right. You're a linebacker, you would have stomped on his arm.
But I just kind of felt bad for him.
I never heard any other guy that got in a high school fight, got punched in the head, and goes, I'm not sure what I should do right now.
It was like one of the weirdest things. I don't know.
Like, you got
to
give him credit that we got a punch off and he connected.
He did. And he kind of surprised me.
Right. They all remembers that when I went to WNAW do mornings, I got greeted by O&A, who obviously didn't care about any of the show at the point at that time. They were killing it. They go, who's the new morning guy? What is this, Menudo?
What? Did we say that?
We might have.
We probably did.
They were bringing in so many different mornings.
Yeah.
That's why, Carton.
Wow.
They put so many guys in front of us. We knew they were they were going to be there for only a little time.
It's so fucking
He's
funny.
He's kicking ass now, man. Holy
fuck. Yeah, yeah. They're doing really well.
He was part of the sports guys on AEW with...
Sports guys! Sports guys!
With what's his name?
What the fuck was his name?
Oh, help me out.
Oh, I know. Sid.
Rosenberg, Sid, of course.
Sid, yeah, Jesus. Sid has had his own issues over the years. No, they're fucking great, man. Everybody, everyone loves Boomer and Carton. They do a really good job.
That's funny.
It is. It
hit
really
him so
is.
Hard, he felt bad for you, and he forgot he was in a fight and wanted to help you.
Boomer's also really a nice guy, very charitable. Like, he does a lot of charity work and stuff, so... No, he's a good. He was a prick on wheels as a kid.
Well, we saw him at the golf outing.
Yeah, the golf.
You guys talked about that day.
Yeah, pretty
and he
fucking
was laughing
funny.
His ass off.
It's so weird when you're like, you know, that many years ago something happens. You go through your life, and then you end up like in a radio career. Both of you. It's fucking odd.
Really strange.
And then I got like Adam Ferrara as another friend of mine that ends up, you know, doing TV.
Nurse Jackie now, right?
Very odd.
Oh, yeah.
Nurse Jackie, and he's still doing Top Gear. And yeah, very fucking weird little circle of people I have roamed with over the years. Yeah. But I probably did start crying when I punched Boomer in the head.
Anyone breaking their arm is going to fucking cry, no?
I was using the fucking prison strategy we were talking about. You get the biggest guy. You got to get that first punch in. Just slam him in the fucking head. I had this fucking when the punch was landing, because everything is in slow motion. When the punch is landing, I'm thinking, fuck, I'm going to nail this guy. This is going to be great. I'm going to fucking knock out the biggest guy in school. I'm going to be the shit.
In front of your house this happened too?
This is in the school yard.
Oh, he keeps saying how you came out of your house.
No, this is...
He doesn't remember it correctly.
In the school. Believe me, I remember every fucking detail. Because I was like, oh my God, I fucking got him. This is the shot. I'm going to fucking lay out Boomer Esiason, and I'm going to be the guy that knocked out Boomer.
No.
Crackle! Old Graham Cracker wrist. Fucking.
I would imagine that prison strategy of hitting the biggest guy is the dumbest thing you could do in the
end.
Who the fuck is going to go, oh, wow, that was impressive. All right, I guess we'll leave him alone. And I guess the big, huge monster is going to now leave him alone, too.
No.
Of course not.
First of all, the big guy is going to go, well... He's not going to surprise me again.
Right.
I'm going to walk up to him and snap his pencil neck.
Exactly.
Yeah, that whole like commercial came out recently when she's like 9 years old and doing a commercial.
Yeah.
I think. Mammy, mammy.
She's on. She's on a TV show when she was a little kid called Nick Frino, something teacher.
Mm. Oh, yeah?
I used to watch it. He was, like, the cool teacher, and I was like, oh, I wish I had Nick Frino as my teacher.
Did she launch a fucking... Did she launch a quarter off her ankle?
No, she didn't have talent like me.
You wish Nick Frino was your teacher?
Of course, he was cool.
What a fag.
I didn't have any... What, you touch the kids?
I didn't have any cool teachers.
Did you... Yeah.
No,
I don't have anything. You kidding me? I'm out of it.
I was only going to say, because I was watching a Skyfall commercial as we were talking. It's on I almost wonder if anybody saw it.
I saw
Ant
it.
Saw it.
I saw it over the weekend.
What'd you think?
Yeah, I liked it. I like that James Bond shit. It's fucking good.
Wait, you're saying it in a way like what?
What?
Is it a good movie?
Yeah.
You said I liked it in a weird way like...
No, I'm like, I know I like others, that shit.
But it sounded like I know others aren't liking it, but I liked it.
No, I don't think others aren't liking it. I think it's doing pretty well.
It was just the way you said it, that's all.
Oh, no, I didn't mean anything by it.
How bummed are you that you can't post any of these pictures or videos? Be honest.
I posted that one.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I posted a couple of the pictures. The videos, though, they kind of get a little iffy about the video.
Oh, then you can talk about it. Ant went shooting with Daniel Craig, man.
It's a great shot.
Yeah, it did. It was great.
We sort of talked about it on the air a little bit.
Yeah. It was fucking fun.
Is he British?
Oh, he's very British.
Oh, he is? Okay.
Was he on Long Island? He wasn't filming Skyfall, was he?
No. No. He had some business.
Yeah.
Business.
And then Ant ends up, you spend what, though? Pretty much the afternoon with him?
Yeah. Hung out, went shooting. A couple of beers at the house.
How weird is that, being just a Long Island guy, that all of a sudden he's in your house drinking beers with you?
Yeah, it's like a James Bond.
If you said, would you blow me, would you? I mean, it's Bond, though.
I know. You know, you got to take that into consideration, but not my type. Not my fucking type.
What if that turned? What if the beer drinking turned into...
Jesus. Why does it always have to go that way?
That's how we are. I don't know. What if he just, you know...
I don't think so.
Hey, very big biceps.
You know. I was just noticing that. Yes. Like, he's a well-built guy.
He's in shape.
He gets in shape for the movies.
How does he look with his shirt off?
Well, I didn't see him with his shirt off in person.
Did you
I saw
enjoy
the movie.
It when he came out of your pool all wet?
Didn't come out of the pool, glistening in his James Bond swimsuit. No.
Imagine if he went swimming in your pool in his James Bond swimsuit.
How quickly would the afternoon have ended if you had been like, you're just sitting at the bar, and then you just looked at him and said, so did you bring the bathing suit?
Well, if you had one for me, do you want to put this on? Go for a dip.
Like Fast Times at Ridgemont High with Damone, I just hold it up. These will fit you.
But let's really break this down for a second.
No, we don't. Why?
You guys
Why
went
we
shooting
to?
All day, and then you had a few beers in your basement at the compound. What would it have taken for you to tell Daniel Craig he has to leave?
Oh, that's a good one.
All right? Like, the beards were cool. The conversation was cool.
I don't know.
What if he said, hey, I saw a pool out there, and unfortunately, I don't have my swim trunks, so I'm going to have to go in naked. Is that okay with
Jesus.
You?
Jesus.
Well, the rules of the compound are if you don't have a bathing suit.
You've said it many times.
That's
what would it
girls.
Take, though, where it gets so weird and awkward?
I got some fucking extra swim trunks
all right, so
for
good
guests
there.
Here. So
yeah, but what if he put them on, and then he jumped in the pool, and then he got out and went, oh, they slipped off.
And he has
why are you saying this?
And
like,
he has
this
a big,
and
he
has a what if.
He has a big 007 boner at that point.
Where we pulled back his foreskin, and he went, look what we can hide in here. Look. He's trying to show you that he can hide little things between the head and skin.
You guys are assholes.
Where you literally go, look, you have to fucking go. I don't give a fuck. You're the new Bond.
Well, if...
you got to get the hell out of here.
If things got at all gay, I would have to tell him to leave, because that's not my bag, man.
But if it's a little gay, it's James Bond. I'm thinking in your head, you're like, you know what? It's James Bond. I don't think anyone's going to fault me.
That was actually an issue with the movie. He said there won't, you know, he doesn't think there would be a gay Bond, and there are some scenes in the new Bond movie where the villain, what's his name there? He's
Javier Bardem?
Yeah. He's fucking such a good bad guy.
He's great.
Where he kind of alludes to the fact that he might be attracted to James.
Oh really?
And, yeah, there's one scene like that. It's pretty funny.
That could have been you.
So what happens if you're both, if you're in the hot tub?
Good.
But you're just hanging, you're drinking.
Uh-huh.
But he still has his swim trunks
on.
But it's obvious that he's a bit turgid as he gets out to find his towel.
The bubbles are on.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you realize that his bathing suit is floating off to the side somewhere else.
Sam has this whole fantasy where he just can't keep that bathing suit on.
Well, why would he? He's James Bond.
But what if his balls and cock wouldn't fit in the suit? Like, when he sat up, it was just ball out one end and cock out of the other end?
Yeah, you guys really know how to fuck something up.
What?
You know what he
would do? This is very fucking cool. And
why else would a grown man come back to your house for a beer in the middle of the day?
That's exactly right.
Men shooting. Drink a couple of Guinness. Kind of nice.
He'd put on board shorts, but then he'd untie them. So they were still on, but then he'd jump out of the water real quick so the water would push him off. And he'd go, whoops. Whoopsie.
Hey, you wanted it as much as I did.
Yeah, you'd finally let him into the pool house and he'd come real quick. Like
Damone.
Hey,
this is a great shake and not stirred martini.
You know he's never coming back to your house, so I would just post a video. Fuck it. Oh,
you
might get someone else in trouble.
Oh, you gotta have some respect.
Third party.
Gotta have some respect.
If it's a third party thing, then I fully understand.
Yeah, it's a friend of ours.
But if it's not a third party thing, I would just fucking post that.
Nah, I'm a big good
You
guy.
Want to post it. I know you do.
Well, who wouldn't?
What was he shooting that day? Cool. You allowed to say?
Yeah, a little bit of everything.
Rifle. Oh, yeah, a little bit of everything. Exactly. It's like, there's no silencer on this gun. Yeah.
Oh, what are you
Aim
saying?
Aim for the tonsils.
I think Sarah has gay fantasy.
He really does.
Yeah, it's all started with that teacher. The cool teacher.
Nick Freno.
Nick Freno.
It's very obvious. We're trying to...
Right. They thought he was one of the homeless.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
2006 was the one that got the most heat, right? We got a lot of TV coverage on that one.
I think that was the last one we did.
Right.
It was the best one, I think.
It was also the one we had to do on a Saturday.
Yes.
Because they wouldn't let us do it during the week.
And I'm not... I swear I'm all in with Tim Sabian and Don Wicklund, but I have to relay another quick little tip.
Yeah.
And Tim goes, and I want to do homeless shopping spree again.
Oh, that's cute.
And I just had the over-the-top Robert De Niro fucking... King of Comedy. No, not even that one. I had this one.
Ah, yes.
This one.
That's terrific. That's terrific.
And once again, he goes, come on, just give me a chance. I'm like, I'm telling you, they will not let us do the homeless shopping spree again without these crazy rules.
Ain't going to happen.
Right. Remember when, I forgot the guy's name that used to run the channel.
Incarnation?
He didn't have hair. I remember that.
Oh, yeah, that's...
Remember he...
No hair.
He's like, good news, we're going to do the homeless shopping spree. And then he started calling the malls for permission. I'm
for
like,
permission.
Can't do that.
And sending out, like, contracts to the malls.
Right. I'm like, you can't
That's good. That really captures the spirit of what we were doing.
Right. But at that point, you just got to accept we can't do it. You can't. Yeah, yeah. You got to understand that would never work.
E-Rock, comment?
No, I was just moving it. But they did come up with a solution. You're forgetting
they did.
That.
Yes.
Well,
yes.
I was trying not to beat them up too bad today.
I remember the solution.
The Costco's solution? Yes.
Let's open a Costco at 7 a.m.
Just
so
for
they
us.
Can shop by themselves.
That suggestion got me banned from sales meetings because I laughed at somebody.
You see?
Right.
Good for you, by the way, getting banned from those.
Yeah, wait, what's his name?
Waste of time.
Got mad at, Ross, right? I like naming names. Ross.
You
got,
sure do.
Ross got really mad. He couldn't believe that. He couldn't believe that we didn't see it his way. I'm like, it's not the homeless shopping spree unless we do it in a mall and our listeners get to show up.
What the?
That's what was in this.
Oh.
I want to thank this Friday the 13th. Is this an official commercial?
You can't just.
Your friends at Paramount Pictures.
No.
I want to make sure you're prepared.
No. They send you something. It doesn't mean you get to advertise. They don't get free advertising because they send gifts.
Oh, well, because that's illegal.
All you have to do is send me a gift and I'll plug your stuff.
No.
But you can't be involved in something that's illegal.
What?
Our wonderful sponsors pay money to have you guys mention their products. We can't have.
What
can't
good
cheapen
is Plugola if you can't Plugola?
Plugola is not good.
No.
Paramount Pictures want to make sure you are prepared for the release
Don't worry about what's coming
out. It's the end of the year. No one's really... Everyone has their guard down. Everyone's cool.
No, the new
Paranormal Activity, the marked ones, in theaters on January 3rd, 2014.
The last Paranormal Activity was terrible.
In close, please find all the essential safeguards your local...
That's so stupid.
Botanica can provide to protect you from black magic. We encourage you to cleanse your spirit and ward off any bad luck or darkness. Hopefully this way you will get to see...
into that
2014.
All right, I
what's
guess
in the box
like
the
some
box?
Kind of anti ghost things.
It's one of those boxes I don't know how to open though.
Yeah,
how do you
which
open
way does
type?
It open? Where's the flap?
Well, the flaps are like tucked in, and then like what do you do? You just pull hard?
I don't know. Yeah, why not?
I'm not gonna keep this crap. I mean, this great.
Oh, there you go. Now, this will protect you from paranormal activity. What's that, a jar? Ooh, very good.
Oh,
spooky.
I'm going to pee in that in a minute.
Oh, man. What's that for? Oh, man.
Holy
it's like you're
water.
Gonna, it's like you're going to make fucking
make
some
shit.
Freebase.
Oh, maybe that's what it's for.
Yeah. What is that?
Give this to Dennis. I'm sure he could shove it up some girl's ass. The next office party. It's a soft egg.
What? A soft egg? What's that for? And a candle.
Oh, you got a candle in here.
A candle. So you could burn that.
Okay.
What is this to protect you? And what is that?
The marked ones in theaters January 3rd. Protection oil.
Protection oil. Can you use that for ass lube? Because you might want to give that to Denny, too.
Yeah, let's do that.
Denny might need that.
Sam, it just says the marked ones in theaters January 3rd.
No, what
protection
do you say?
Oil.
Any copy machine paper?
I'm just telling the people what it is.
Don't worry about what it is. This isn't even... This doesn't make any sense.
Copying that ass. That huh? ass.
You want that ass copy?
That ass. That's Wait, so funny.
Take that shit home with me.
You make this shit.
What is that? What do you do? It's holy water. That could come in handy.
Right.
Vampires.
You got some evil coin.
What is that?
Oh, Our Lady of Guadalupe, mystical rose, make intercession for Holy Church. Protect the sovereign pontiff. Help all those who invoke thee in the end.
Don't say it. Oh, no.
And their necessities. And since thou art the ever virgin Mary, a mother of the true God.
Being from the Necronomicon.
Obtain for us from the most holy Son the grace of keeping our faith.
Rata.
Sweet hope in the midst of bitterness of life, burning charity, and the precious gift of final perseverance.
That's scary.
I'm hoping to get some voice work.
So yeah. That's why I did that.
Oh.
Add it to the demo
reel.
For a
scary movie?
Yeah, scary movie shit.
Damn.
And I guess this is how to protect yourself from paranormal activity in 10 steps.
So you only need a candle, some holy water, and a mason jar?
Yeah, and you say those words I did.
How about how to protect yourself from paranormal activity is to stay away from the fucking movie theater.
And what, yeah. And what's with the cushy egg?
I don't know.
Like, what are you supposed to do with that?
It doesn't explain what you do with all this stuff.
That doesn't make sense.
I don't know. Just whatever.
All right.
You don't have to open up your box.
Certainly don't.
I hate when they give us the same shit.
Right in the fucking garbage.
Especially when it's garbage.
I got twin brothers in my family, but I now understand their life.
Yeah.
Because me and Ann always get the same fucking
same
shit.
Same thing.
Oops.
Uh-oh. Did it break? Sounded broke.
No, it's all right. I want to thank Dr. That. Steve for the bottle of wine he sent me. And boy, did I go right on wine.com. And it looks like Dr. Steve had a fine year.
Dr. Steve sent you a bottle of wine?
At home.
It was sent to your home?
Yeah, but I sent him a Nutribullet.
What the hell's that? Oh, that thing. The mixer thing. Oh, man. Dr. Steve. Well, I got you. You know what I got you? Nothing.
Well, the problem with Dr. Steve is he can't accept a good gesture without doing a good gesture back
reciprocating, yes.
So because I gave him a Nutribullet, he's like, oh, I got to give him a bottle of wine. It's like, no, just accept my little gift. You said you liked making smoothies, so I gave you my my Nutribullet, which
kind
I love.
What kind of wine?
It I forgot the name, but I looked it right up. Oh. It's nice. It's got that fancy font where it's really hard to read what
that's
it says
a good wine right there. That's a good wine right there. You know how I tell a good wine? The price. That's all I do.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I walk into the store. I go, if I want a good bottle of wine, I get like a $75, $80 bottle of wine.
Right.
If I want a pretty good bottle of wine, $30 range there, something like that. And then the cheap shit's like $8, $10, $15.
But there's a wine store in my neighborhood, and they will tell you why that's all bullshit. I don't drink a lot of wine these days, but I started going in there because I was buying Duckhorn and Silver Oak, the wine people know.
Oh, yeah.
Those are like, they're almost $100 a bottle in the
fancy schmancy.
In the liquor store. So I finally go to this place, what is it called? Wine 67? I forget the name. On Columbus Avenue. And they have a wine person in there. And they go, all right, what do you buy at a regular liquor store? And I tell them, they're like, ha, ha, ha. And they go, yeah, of course that's good stuff. But let me show you something that's just as good for, I can't even say half, like a third of the price.
Oh.
And I go, well, why is it only this much? And they're like, because no one knows about it yet.
Ah.
So they can't charge $100 a bottle yet.
That's odd.
And I picked up some amazing wines for a lot fucking cheaper.
I have noticed, though, in my wine tastings, that the more expensive wine does taste a little better.
Yeah. In general.
Yeah, in general.
But there's also a lot of...
I'm sure there's some, you know...
There's a lot of new players, but they just can't... No one knows about them, so they can't charge a lot of
money. Got no traction yet.
Right, so...
Mm-hmm.
So I ended up saving a lot of money thanks to that place.
Yeah.
And it was all stuff I never heard of. Never. And it was like $15, $20. I'm like, really? Yeah. And they're like, trust me.
Mm.
And I did, and you know, in most cases, it was absolutely really good. Whatever.
Good stuff, Dr. Steve.
That's always good when you end a segment with whatever.
What is that? Something they teach you in broadcasting school.
Right.
Just end your sentence with whatever.
That means you have no confidence in what you just said. Great. Great. Whatever.
Shit.
We were talking about Christmas and how it's a dirty word these days.
Oh, it certainly is.
And everyone's just losing their minds over it.
Yes, very
and like
politically incorrect to even talk about Christmas.
Yeah, not a hint. I dropped my kid off yesterday. Just I wanted to make sure, and not a hint of a Christmas decoration in the classroom.
No,
that is just fucking weird to me, man.
That's the little kid from Christmas Story.
Yeah.
Holy shit, he's a man.
What do you mean?
That's the put your eye out kid. But he's like a man.
Looks like Jim Chandler.
Does he? Oh.
Looks like my old pal, Jim Chandler.
Pal.
Yeah, we're pals again.
Oh, good.
I like everything that he tweets and Instagrams.
Oh, everything?
Yeah, even if I don't like it. I'm really,
like he click like.
I'm really sucking up as much as I can to him.
You see the new blocking policy on Twitter?
No.
Did they change it and then change it back?
I just heard about the change. I haven't heard about no change back yet. Apparently, now when you block somebody, they can still see everything you're tweeting. but you no longer see anything that they write. So it's like backwards blocked.
Yeah.
So, but they are never informed that you have blocked them. So it saves you from having to read their drivel, and they don't know when you blocked them, so they can't just make a new account and harass you and things like that. That was Twitter's logic with the whole thing is, well, it keeps them from just perpetually harassing because they don't know they were blocked anyway. So I don't know if it works. I like the satisfaction of blocking someone and, you know, you cannot now read my magic, my words of wisdom, my eloquence, my comedy.
Just say your brilliance.
Let's brilliance. All right. I like that.
Well, the gift of at Anthony Cumia is something
the
that...
gift. Why? Right.
It's a privilege.
Why do I want to keep
right.
giving them the gift? The gift. Like chlamydia.
I just got a communique from Steven Singer himself.
Oh, wow.
I told
wow.
you we were pals. It's no bullshit.
Steven Singer.
He writes, we own the whole building.
Oh. Lest you say he doesn't own the whole building.
But in this text, I think he's in agreement that he doesn't want you dropping deuces in his building.
No, no one wants to come in to buy a diamond ring from Steven Singer Jewelers and then smell wafting shit in the room.
He writes, would you let someone like you behind the counter with the diamonds? A lot of question marks. That's why I'm shouting.
Oh, boy.
And then he writes, I barely let you in the showroom.
You know what happens?
And then he writes, you are the best. Aww. Aww.
You know what happens when you take a big dump like that and then add millions of years of heat and pressure?
Huh.
Turns into a big, hard diamond. Yeah.
So maybe he's collecting duties.
That's what
probably
I'm thinking.
Is.
And putting it into a big pressure cooker.
Big pressure cooker.
He's a long-term guy.
Oh, yeah. He looks at the big picture.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I actually like going down there. It's fun. That whole area is kind of cool.
Yeah.
Twitter.
Yeah, absolutely.
I've never been down there.
You got to go.
Oh, yeah, you do.
You got to go for the tour. It's pretty amazing.
Killadelphia, yo.
Yep. Yeah. They did have to change their shit because everybody, all the Twitter users were like, no, I don't want people I block seeing my stuff.
They changed it back?
So they changed it back.
Wow, like Coke, New Coke, and then Classic Coke.
Except they only took a few hours.
They only took a few hours.
All right.
It pissed everybody off. Yeah. I know. It really got a mess.
So now it's just how it was?
Yes.
Same as it ever was.
But everybody got really upset because yeah, when you block people, you don't want them to get to see the gifts of brilliance that you bestow upon the internet.
I kind of see their point, though. If you block somebody and they don't know they're blocked by you, and you can no longer read what they write, who cares what they write then?
And they probably won't start new accounts to keep harassing you.
That was their whole point. But we have this thing where we need to say, no, I want to take something away from you.
Yeah, it's supposed to be a punishment.
Right. I am blocking you from my... What was the word you used, Opie?
Brilliance.
Brilliance. My brilliance.
Jesus. All right, I'm gonna flip that on you now.
Yeah,
your brilliance was very evident in the old Howard Stern video that I posted on my YouTube page.
There it is. I forgot about
that's
that
doing
completely.
Really well, by the way. I want to thank Brian, our old intern at AM.
Man,
I got a lot of the Real Rock TV tapes, but he's finding stuff I don't even have.
He's finding gold nuggets.
Know what one I want badly, and I told him. But maybe someone else that might have been taping back then. We didn't have as many tapers as we do nowadays. No. But I want the TV piece we did where we killed Elmo. You want to talk about douche
chills. Yeah. With the fake car drive.
Yeah. And the wood chipper. I got to get that.
Oh, boy, was that douchey. They're all douchey, but.
Did Ian go AWOL years ago on us?
I think so.
Yeah. What was his issue with us?
Well, I think he had some misplaced affections.
Yeah, I think he kind of wanted to pop me in the hiney.
Yeah, that's another way to put it. That's how Denny would put it. I'm going to pop you in the hiney.
I think there might have been a little something.
Yeah.
I don't know. On his part, trust me.
Boy.
You noticed that too.
Oh, huh? Everybody did. Everyone did. Did you see the clip Brian posted of Rocco?
No, I didn't click on that one yet.
It was pretty good because at one point Rocco in the clip just goes, dude, really loud.
Is it worth playing on the radio?
Well, to get a little taste of Rocco.
Yeah.
If you want a little taste,
and you
got to
play the Ant doing the Howard thing too, because that works as a radio bit.
That was I have a where'd they get that wig? It's perfect. It's a big giant.
I don't even remember
1990s Howard wig.
I don't remember you doing that one.
I don't either. But then again, I was intoxicated most of the time to get away from my wife.
Right.
What? Yeah, that one I saw, the Howard thing, the Howard one I saw on one of the tapes.
Right.
Oh, and that goes through an entire episode. Like, it keeps...
Oh, I keep going back,
going back to Howard.
Yeah, so he
edited
it. Oh. He edited it nicely into one quick minute video. Nice. Which you can find on my YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Where's the Rocco thing?
So how you feeling, man?
So how you feeling, man?
How you feeling, man?
How you feeling, man?
Is this one? Rockhole?
Probably Rockhole.
Yeah, it might be.
Hey, Rocco's psychotic line ringing.
Aw, look at Rocco.
Hello, hello, this is Rocco.
Yes, it's the psychiatric network.
This is Rocco's psychotic network, kid. Psychotic.
I'm sorry, I've never called one of these before.
What's your name?
One of his bits.
My name's Bob.
Bob, what's your birthday? Let me see if I can help you.
2/14 in 1973. I'm 21, I can drink.
Can you now?
Yeah.
You were born on Valentine's Day?
Yeah.
What's your problem there, Bob?
Every time I take off my pants in front of my girlfriend, she laughs.
It's classic dude.
So what you're saying is if you took an inch off your penis, you would have a pimple on your ass. Dude, I bet you I can tell you your girlfriend's name.
No, it's a good dude.
Okay.
Ginger.
What the? How'd you know that?
Dude, I know all!
Oh, God.
It's the Rocco dude. Dude!
Rest in peace, brother. Rest in peace. Yeah, we lost the Rocco a couple years ago.
A banana, my Rocco. Yeah, Rocco's dead.
I gotta say, we hated that we had to do bits with the other fucking guys at the station.
So bad.
We hated they were part of the TV show. We hated that they were part of the CDs. Then we finally branched out and was able to get a CD of just our stuff out
there. Yeah. God, it's so weird looking at that. He's got the mullet cranking. It's fucking, I remember that studio so vividly. Mm-hmm. And look, the Denon fucking CD player.
Same CD player.
It's the same CD players we're using right here. There you go.
And that's about 95, 96 right there.
Yeah, there you go.
96 probably.
And they were old. But look at all the carts behind them. Dude, I fucking totally remember sitting there. Oh, God. It was a million years ago, though. So excited to be doing radio. It was great.
We're still excited, right, guys?
I'm so excited. I can't hide it.
Good.
I'm about to lose control, and I think I like it.
The one bad thing about doing a podcast every week, you got to fucking read the tweets. God, you guys really were into it a few years ago.
Oh, jeez.
We're still into it.
2014 is going to be a big, big year for this show.
Don't worry about it. Relaunch. Everything's going to be
great. It's going to be relaunch. You guys are going to come back strong.
Yeah.
You're going to enjoy the show.
I do.
Things are going to get done. You're going to re-sign in October.
Oh, boy. Resign? Spelt the same, isn't it? Isn't re-sign and resign spelt the same?
Sure, and they're so close
right
now.
And it means the complete opposite of each other. What the fuck?
Do Anthony's impression of Howard from the old days, from our Real Rock TV. I'll say it, our Real Rock TV show, not the stations.
The visual aspect is the old dark studio from an overhead cam, and I got a giant Howard wig on and the sunglasses,
right.
So it's supposed to, you know, look like it.
Ooh, did you see that, Robert? Another blatant example of how they're ripping me off. I'm an innovator. No one's ever original anymore. That was obviously a blatant ripoff of me, the king of everything. I'm disgusted.
Oh, boy.
Okay, we're back, and... I have some more. I'm being ripped off again, Robin. Have you heard this WAF Real Rock TV? They're filming inside the radio station with video cameras. Who thought of that, Robin? Me, Howard. I invented the video camera. And now they got this Real Rock TV where they're going to be showing behind the scenes of radio station. It's an outrageous ripoff, Robin. Well, we're out of time again. Wow, where does the time go, Robin? I got to get the plugs in, catch Jerky the Jackman at the Bayonne Comedy Toilet. Oh. And our interview with Stammering Jim tomorrow, where he actually kicks Mother Teresa. It's hysterical. I'd like to thank all of my guests today. And Robin, I want to thank you. And most of all, I want to thank me. And we'll see you next time. Are we done? Hey, Robin, that Real Rock TV, the tape I saw, it's really not that bad. It's a pretty good show, actually. I think I got some ideas from that.
And then he walks away. That's an extremely accurate impression. Extremely.
The giant wig.
Yep. We got to take a break because we went really long with the first break.
Ooh.
And then we're going to come back with Mike Buscetti on the phone.
Nice.
He's been waiting pretty much 3 days to talk to us.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll talk to him next about not being able to find.